The world always has an original, whether it is in art or whether it is in everyday. What happens if this is replicated and remade? Does it live up to the original? The Literary License Podcast explores the world of the original and remake as we explore and see if the remake truly stands up to the original. With your hosts Joe Randazzo, John Wilson, Vicky Ray, and Keith Chago, where they ask the question, does the remake live up to the original?
Hello, welcome to Literary License Podcast, and it's Make Remake Week. We'll be discussing two films, the original and the remake. And this month, we are covering The Women from 1939 and The Opposite Sex from 1956. And before we get started, let's find out who's with us. We got Vicky Ray with us. Hello, Vicky.
Hi, everybody.
And Joe Randazzo with us. Hello, Joe.
Hello, everyone.
And with much to do, let's find out what we've been up to since last time we've seen each other. Starting with you, Vix, what have you been up to?
Well, I'm finally healthy. We all had a pretty hefty dose of RSV tear through my family. It wasn't like COVID. I'd almost rather have COVID than this one because this one affected my lungs and everything else, gave me another sinus infection. Oh my God, man, just like the slew of viruses. But other than that, just getting ready for Thanksgiving. People getting time off here and there, so I'm kind of busy with a fam. But I finished watching Warrior Nun, that series. I don't know. It looks like we're going to have season 3 on Netflix.
Yeah, it's been greenlit season 3. So
I was just wondering because they couldn't leave it like that. I was getting a little pissy halfway through this season, and then they kind of finally beefed it back up where I was, you know, getting into it again. I actually like it. A lot of people are slamming it. I thought it was pretty good so far. You know, no complaints. I'm still watching The Crown, but avoiding the last few episodes because I just don't want to go through that again. I already lived through the news and everything else, but, you know, I've finished.
Spoiler alert, she dies.
That's what I'm saying. I don't want to go through that again, but I'm going to finish watching it. I will. Watched Smile 2 days ago. It was on Peacock. Yeah, Peacock. No, Paramount. It's on Paramount. Everybody thought it was going to be really shitty. And it, I really actually liked it. I thought it was a pretty decent, intense, you know, kind of thriller, scary movie. I mean, it's fucked. Just the smiling part just fucked with me alone. I don't understand why everybody's upset about it. I liked it. It was good.
I'll be seeing that probably today.
Yeah, I think you'll like it. What? Oh, and I watched Barbarian. I was waiting for you, Joe, about Barbarian because it had nods to like a million films. And you wrote a nice big thing. I knew you would.
Well, I tried to avoid spoilers as well as I can because I know a lot of people. I mean, I feel like anybody who says it's like nothing they've ever seen before is kind of telling on themselves a little because they haven't watched a lot of horror, because there's a lot of movies that I've seen references to in that.
It was one of those movies, though, that I wanted to shower immediately after. You can always tell what kind of movie it is if I feel like bathing after I watch it, because it just makes you feel icky and gritty. It's sort of like Golden Glove. I always go back to Golden Glove as my I need a shower kind of fucking movie.
I think I feel like that. Anytime I see Richard Brake in any movie, I feel immediately like I need a shower afterwards. He plays a sleazeball like no one else.
Yeah, he does put the S in sleaze. But on the lighter side, though, I did watch A Christmas Story yesterday, the new one.
I haven't seen the new one yet.
It's not as good. You can't beat the first one, but it's got a lot of good moments. And, you know, I had to break from all the slashing and the eyeballs and, you know, all the geriatric sex and just take a break and watch something else.
Remaking A Christmas Story is going to be quite difficult because the way that the film is done, it's done by Bob Clark, who did Porky's. Right. And, of course, he did the first slasher film really outside of Psycho was
Black Christmas.
Olivia Hacey.
Right.
Yeah, Black Christmas.
Black Christmas. So, but for some reason he had this really nice charm because I think that he kind of knew that A Christmas Story when he made it was kind of like a reflection of his Christmases and the way he remembers it. So it'll be interesting to see how a millennial director is going to look back on a 1940s or 50s Christmas.
It's not a 40s Christmas. It's 74. He's grown up. He has family now. It's not a redo. It's a continuation.
Okay, that's fine.
So it's got a lot of pleasant surprises in it. You know, like some of the old friends are there and stuff. A lot of the kids show up that were in it prior. They're all adults in our age now.
Oh, sorry. I thought it was like a remake. I was like,
No. It's a continuation. Ralphie's older. He's got his own kids. His struggles with life and all the bullshit that happens Christmas when he goes home. You know, the drama of visiting home or the drama. I'm not going to tell you what happens because.
Is the father still alive? Because he died. He died.
That's what brings him back to home.
McGavin.
Yeah. He passes away and that's what brings him back to visit home. So I think he's living in Chicago and he's an aspiring writer and he gives himself a year. But that's all I'll say. And then he goes back home. But
we covered A Christmas Story. That was in our first year. We read the book and watched the film because it's based on Gene Shepherd's. It's his story. So Gene Shepherd. So I'm like,
check that out. You'll like it. I mean, it's not as good, but it has a lot of fun moments in it. You know, I mean, it's just a nice diversion because, you know, pretty soon I'm probably going to be watching Silent Night, Bloody Night and all that other stuff. Speaking of, I think there's another Silent Night coming out
Violent Night, which looks really fun. It looks like it's going to be like a hostage situation where the real Santa ends up taking out the terrorists. It looks like a
fun guy movie. From Stranger Things is Santa.
David Harbour, yeah.
Yeah, okay. That looks good though. That looks like a fun little
But the thing about A Christmas Story Christmas, which is such a redundant title, I guess it's got to figure it out somehow. From the trailer, it looks like it's basically the same movie again, just with everybody older. It looks like they did what they did with Three from Hell, Hocus Pocus 2, Jay and Silent Bob Reboot. We're getting these sequels that are just the same exact movie, the same beat kinda for beat sorta. Again. That's what it looks like it is. I haven't seen it yet. I'll probably see it probably in the next couple days.
I was laughing because
I got a lot to catch up on.
I was laughing because Barbarian, everybody thought it was going to be a Barbarian movie. That's why I was laughing. It's like, no, I don't know why they called it Barbarian because it was Barbarian behavior, I guess.
No, the street. The house is on Barbary Street.
Oh, that's right. Okay. But a lot of people didn't put that together.
Yeah,
I mean, it is quite weird that they're doing these sequels and kind of remaking like the original because if you think about it, they didn't do that before home video and they didn't do that before streaming. So now that everything's at your fingertips, why don't they just expect people just to watch the original and then watch the sequel afterwards? Because everything's at your fingertips now. In the past, it wasn't. You know, if you went to saw a Thin Man and you wanted to see the Thin Man Returns, I mean, you had to watch the original Thin Man when it came out before you went to see it.
Yeah. It's a weird little phenomenon that in the case of the Rob Zombie one and the Kevin Smith one, they both went to theaters too.
For which even one?
Three from Hell, Jay and Silent Bob Reboot, Hocus Pocus 2 at least went right to streaming. I kind of even felt like Clerks 3 at points was kind of like we're just going to redo some of the bits from the first movie. I mean, that's ultimately what I've kind of soured on with a lot of these movies. Like, I like Clerks 3 for, like, how it grows the characters. But at the same time, like, I get fan service sells, but I feel like a lot of these movies have become, like, too fan service-y. Where it's like,
right.
Even Star Wars, the first Star Wars movie of the new trilogy was, what was it called again? The Force Awakens.
Yeah.
Was it the
Force Awakens?
Yeah. That was a 2015 one. It was just the first Star Wars movie again. So, like, I feel like everybody realizes that everyone's nostalgic for these movies, and then they're just making the same movie again. Yeah. Like, they're not really adding anything.
Somebody
to the story.
Out there has a different script, I guarantee it. It just can't, like, you always tell me, it's hard to get it in there.
It just can't get made.
I mean, I'm going to watch probably Disenchanted tonight on Disney Plus because it's a sequel to Enchanted.
I'm trying to remember Enchanted.
Well, Enchanted was with Amy Adams and
Michelle Trachtenberg.
No, it's basically what happened was, is that basically she's living in this cartoons world, and it's a really piss take about Disney cartoons.
That was 2007. Oh my God.
And she gets knocked back in. She gets knocked back into the real world. And Susan Sarandon plays the evil queen, and they get backed out. And James Marsden plays the Prince Charming, and they're she's like walking around like this dairy princess. I mean, like this Disney princess in New York.
Oh, okay. You're right. Okay, I remember that now. Oh my God, I totally forgot about that movie.
And so, and then basically, you know, by the end of it, she ends up with Dr. Dreamy from
yeah, what's his face? Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, Patrick Dempsey.
Patrick Dempsey. So she ends up with him. Them now sort of thing. So it could be quite fun because they're not remaking it because
that was actually a good movie. Now that I think about it, Susan Sarandon was great in that.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know they made a second one. Oh, all right.
The original. So I mean, it has some great moments. It's like she's walking down the street, and he goes to her, goes, "Are you always happy?" She goes, "Yeah, life is a song." And also, she starts singing. All of a sudden, we start singing with her. and he's looking around, going, "What the hell is this?"
The bird, the bluebirds, and all that other stuff. Yeah. Come to dress and clean. I would just give a freaking my eye teeth if the fucking bluebirds would come to my house and clean just once.
But the funny thing about that though is that when that happens in the movie, she goes, and all these animals come in and start cleaning the house. But then when all the animals leave, there's like bird shit and feathers everywhere.
Yeah. That's right. Oh my God, I didn't know they made a second one. That's great.
Yeah, it's come out today. So
I see it. Yeah, you're right. Oh my God, I'm so watching that.
And this one's called Disenchanted.
I am so watching that. I'm glad you said something. I love the first one.
Well, then by the sound of it, it sounds like this title is going to be the reverse.
Yeah.
Possibly. So maybe they actually are doing something completely different on this one.
We'll see.
And the thing is, I'm not sure. I know Patrick Dempsey and James Marsden's back, right. And Amy Adams is back. So.
Amy Adams came back.
Yeah. So I mean, I don't know anything about it. I saw it advertised today. I was like, oh, okay, I'll probably give that a shot. So what about yourself, Joe? What have you been up to?
I decided to take a couple days this week to catch up on all the Vicky asked what I thought of Barbarian, and I had like a slew of people in my inbox asking what I thought about it. So Monday night, I think it was, I finally had a chance to just sit down. I didn't have anything else I needed to watch. I watched The Women earlier in the day. I was like, all right, I may watch that the next morning, but I just sat down, I just watched it, and I really, really like Barbarian. It was my favorite horror movie of the year for about 17 hours. Until. Because the next morning, my Blu-ray arrived of Pearl. And I wanted to see that in theaters, but I never got a chance.
I'm watching that this weekend.
I finally got a chance to watch Pearl.
They're saying Mia Goth they might nominate her for an Oscar.
If she doesn't get enough, like I realize, okay, it's a horror movie and she's playing a woman who, you know,
perverted.
It's in the trailers, there's nothing. It's you know, basically a woman losing her mind and starting to kill people. Yeah. And I understand that, but it's not that horror movies haven't been nominated before. This is one of my favorite performances of the year. I absolutely love Mia Goth in this.
I have not heard one bad review about that movie yet. I have yet to see anybody say they hated it.
I know a couple people who said they thought it's boring, but whatever. You know.
Well, if you like X, I mean, I loved X. But
that was the weird thing is these people like X and then thought that Pearl was boring. And I'm like, all right, well,
after watching X, you want to see the backstory because, you know, what made this old lady so fucking nuts? Like, what happened to her?
Well, I mean, I think you also have to look at the same, but it's an A24 horror film as well. And the thing is, and they work at their own pace. You know, there are plenty of people who freaking love Hereditary, and there's a lot of people who freaking hate it. And A24 seems to divide people. There's not people who just like their films. You either love them or you really hate them.
Well, normally if it says A24, you know, when the beginning, I'll watch it just because I like their movies. So
I didn't like Lighthouse very much, and I know a lot of people liked it.
Lighthouse. I just didn't understand it, I guess. I was just like, what the fuck did I watch?
But I love The Witch, and I know plenty of people who didn't like The Witch.
I love The Witch, yeah.
That's another one I need to see. I've seen The Lighthouse. I haven't seen Hereditary. I haven't seen The Witch. I have to see both of those. I have them both on my shelf, but I've not thrown them in yet. I will get to them eventually.
I love The Witch. I love how it ended. I'll put it like that.
Do not tell me right now.
I'm not going to tell you. I'm just going to say I loved how it ended.
We covered Witch, Miss Sumner, and Hereditary on our show. So
yeah, Hereditary. Hereditary is just some serious fucked up.
Did you do Midsummer with the Wicker Man? Because those seem to be like
Definitely Midsummer. We did
Hereditary with Miss Sumner because the director was supposed to join us, but then something came up with him.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's true. I forgot about
that. Is that Ari Aster?
Yeah.
I need to see Hereditary. I know something about how Hereditary.
He had interviewed, though, didn't he? Didn't we interview Ari Aster?
No, we never went. We never circled back around. But he's working on something at the moment. So I'll figure once he's finished
that, then we'll
up. But I with Ari Aster, with him, I would suggest going onto YouTube and looking at his three short films.
I might have seen one of them, but I'll go look on YouTube after we're off today.
Yeah, there's the one with the boy who's sexually abusing his father, which is quite interesting.
Well, that's a totally different spin.
Yeah,
I'll check his stuff out after we're done today. And the other movie that I saw, I went to the theater to see The Banshees of Inisharan, which is
you like it.
I absolutely love it. I remember saying, I think I've seen my two favorite movies of the year on the same day because this one is a little bit of a departure. It's not a there's parts of it where you can see as a horror film because you have this old woman who definitely seems to represent death and looks like a witch, but there's nothing overtly horrific about it. Basically. Brendan Gleeson wakes up one day and decides that he no longer wants to be friends with Colin Farrell, who he's been friends with for, decades. And it gets to Colin Farrell is completely in disbelief because he's like, no, dude, you're putting me on, right? Like it's the day before, it's April Fool's Day. So he thinks, okay, he's just fucking with me. This is a massive prank. And finally, Brendan Gleeson lays down that, no, I do not... There's only so much time I have left in this world and I don't want to waste it on somebody. What does he call him again? He calls him something like Simple. He keeps referring to him as Simple, but at one point, limited man. I don't want to waste it on a limited man like you. He wants to do something more important with his life. And he finally lays down the law that, no, listen, I want you to leave me alone. I'm a fiddle player. And every time you bother me, every time you talk to me, I will cut off one of my fingers and I will bring it to you. And at first Colin Farrell and his sister are like, I don't, finally one day he does go talk to him, and the next morning
cuts off
there's
his
a thud at the door. Brendan Gleeson cut off one of his fingers and chucked it at the door. So
ew.
there's a lot going on in this movie. It's set in 1923 on an island off the coast of Ireland.
Interesting.
Watching
it already has isolation going for it.
That's part of it. Is there's themes of wanting to escape your small town when you're somebody who's when you're somebody who has has something going for them. And you want to get out of the small town because you got Colin Farrell's sister who's very well educated. Everyone in the small town thinks she's snobby. And you have on the other end this aging musician who kind of feels like he wasted his life living in this small town. And as he's facing his own mortality, thinks, I really need to do something because I want to be remembered after I die. What do I have left? 15 years? After these 15 years are up, what do I have to show for it? Living on this fucking island, or feckin' island, as they keep saying throughout this thing, living on this feckin' island, talking to a simple man. So there's a lot of there's themes of facing your own mortality. There's themes of wanting to get away from like small-minded people, and then you have this this old witchy-looking woman who at one point even tells Colin Farrell that two people on the island are going to die this month. And she
sounds like the lighthouse.
She reminds me of watching it. Sean and I went to see it in the theater, and afterwards we discussed it in the car. She kind of came off a little bit like some of the shots like looked like they were directly out of the Seventh Seal. And some of the shots also kind of reminded me of Carl Dreyer's Odette. Just some of the landscape shots of Ireland kind of reminded me of Odette a little bit. Very, very good film. A little bit of a departure. If you're looking for a horror movie, it's not a horror movie at all. There's some themes that could be seen as horrific. It's actually a comedy, oddly enough. And the first, the first half of the movie is so unbelievably funny until you realize, no, he means, I mean, it's really Irish insult comedy is what you're getting. Freddie Gleason's just making fun of Colin Farrell for being simple the whole time. And then like the second half, it just the darkness starts to creep in. It's a really, really good movie. So that Pearl Barbarian, I cannot recommend any of those three highly enough. I absolutely love all three of them.
Pearl Barbarian, what was the title, that last title again?
The Banshees of Inisharan.
I saw an advertisement for that. I mean,
that's only in theaters.
That director is an excellent director anyway. Martin McDonald.
Who made In Bruges,
Seven Psychopaths,
Three Billboards Outside of Ebbing, Missouri. Fantastic director. This is probably gonna end up getting nominated for a bunch of Oscars. Yeah. I would not be shocked if it does. The acting is absolutely phenomenal. The direction is phenomenal. It looks beautiful. The cinematography is absolutely gorgeous. So it's very like the color scheme kind of reminded me of The Ring, the 2002 version of The Ring, where everything is kind of murky, like you're being submerged because you're on an island. And I guess it's very overcast the entire movie, which I really, really love. I love the look of the movie. Like everything about the movie I really liked. I would not be shocked to see it nominated for a bunch of Oscars. That Everything Everywhere All at Once is probably going to get a ton of nominations. Pearl deserves it, but probably I don't know if it's going to get it because of the kind of movie it is.
Do you think that they just have an aversion to anything that's like Pearl or whatever?
I feel like when it's like a slasher movie, like this isn't really a slasher movie. Pearl isn't really a slasher movie, but it kind of leans in with like bloody axe murders and stuff like that. Because I mean, even like in the early days of the Oscars, one of the first Best Actor winners was Frederick March for Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Angela Lansbury was nominated for The Picture of Dorian Gray.
Right, that's right.
So it's not like there's like an aversion to horror. But I feel like maybe I don't know.
It's not mainstream enough, I guess.
It's definitely. I mean,
The Exorcist was nominated,
right?
And eventually, Robert Wise, though he didn't get nominated. Robert Wise was kind of a horror director. He never really won for any of his horror movies, but he ended up winning for West Side Story. Spielberg started out doing horror. So I mean, horror is kind of like where everybody really starts out anyway. So. I don't know what it is. I think it's because a lot of times.
Well, Get Out was nominated.
Yeah.
Get Out was. The Sixth Sense was. Silence of the Lambs won Best Picture.
That's true. That is true. I forget.
It's not like there's an aversion. It's just that we don't see it that often. And it gets to the point sometimes where like you feel. I think it's because like the sameness of a lot of horror movies. Like, as much as we love Vincent Price, how many times has he basically played the same role?
Right.
You know, in the Edgar Allan Poe movies, he was basically, once he played Roderick Usher, he basically played Roderick Usher in every movie after.
That's pretty good analogy.
I think that's part of it. It's kind of the sameness of horror. And also, you don't want to nominate Friday the 13th Part 7, you know?
No, I get six. That. But I mean, there's so many movies out there that really did deserve recognition, even though they were scary movies or intense or they were thrillers. Yeah.
But you also got to remember that when it comes to horror films anyway, though they may not be for an Oscar or Golden Globe, they do tend to get nominated for a hell of a lot more awards than a normal movie does, because there are a lot more horror awards that they can be given than awards.
That's true, too. In Pearl's case, it's done well at a lot of the film festivals, so maybe that'll be a little bit of an indicator that it'll do well at a...
I hope it doesn't ruin Ty West. That's all.
I hope not either. Because
would it?
Because it can go to his head, and the next thing you know is like he stops doing like little independent, interesting movies and starts doing big blockbustery kind of films because that's where the money is.
That makes sense.
I mean, yeah. a lot of directors also like you'll see they'll do like Bill Condon will do. After Gods and Monsters, he went and did a couple of Twilight movies, but then he was also doing Mr. Holmes, which I feel like what could happen with a lot of these directors is they'll be like, look, okay, I'll do your silly sparkling vampire movie, but I need you to fund my aging Sherlock Holmes movie that nobody's going to see, but is really, really good. You know,
that just reminded me.
Didn't Bill Condon also do Chicago as well?
Was that Bill Condon? I don't know. I'll look that up, but yeah, he was it might have been Chicago, but he, you know, he was doing like Candyman, Farewell to the Flesh, and then he ended up getting Gods and Monsters, and then let me see here, Bill Condon, why is my Wi-Fi so damn slow today?
Yep,
because everyone's snowed in and using it.
Dreamgirls.
Dreamgirls, that was it. I knew he did a huge musical. So.
Yeah, he did Dreamgirls. I didn't realize he did the Beauty and the Beast.
Chicago movie. Writer Bill Condon interested in Dreamgirls, and that was quite a few years back. So,
He did the Beauty and the Beast remake, the live action Beauty and the Beast remake from a couple years ago, which I didn't realize that was him.
So he's the reason why I had Emily Watson trying to sing.
I tried really hard to like that movie. I did try hard.
Oh, he's doing Guys and Dolls, apparently. I didn't realize that. Okay. So he's doing another big musical. But yeah, you could go that route too, where you could kind of be like, I'll do your little sparkling vampire movies, then I'll do my artsy Sherlock Holmes movie where I was the only person in the theater for that.
They did it. I haven't seen it yet, but I noticed that there's a documentary on there called Forks. Because it's where they did the sparkly vampire movie. They filmed Eclipse and all that, all the vampire movies there. And I guess it's got them quite a little bit of industry in the town. I've tempted to watch it. I've clicked it on, but it looked like some mindless entertainment. Curious to see how the town was affected, the actual town of Fork.
But you know what? Silly as those movies are, Robert Pattinson, Kristen Stewart, Anna Kendrick, all, you know, all are stars now because of it. Yeah. So like I was saying, horror is kind of where you have to start. And sometimes, yeah, it might be a silly little movie, but that silly little movie.
What did she play in recently? Well, I was watching Charlie's Angels for mindless background noise a little while ago, and she was in Charlie's Angels. I didn't even know it was Kristen Stewart. Well, Stewart, oh my God.
Was nominated for the Academy Award last year for, what's the name of the movie? It's escaping me right now. Spencer.
We're covering, at the end of the season, we're covering her film called The Shopper.
I've never seen that one. I know at the, she was in Cronenberg's new movie this year, Crimes of the Future. She was
one of the weird person in that movie. That movie was so weird. I'm going to have to watch it again just to understand what I watched.
But I definitely want to rewatch it.
I mean, out of the hate that she got for Twilight, the thing is, she can be a fantastic actor. She was wonderful in the Runaways movie.
Yes, she was. She was fantastic in that as Joan Jett.
Yeah. I mean, they really didn't give her anything to do in the Twilight movies.
The problem with Bella anyway, I read the first Twilight book and that was enough for me. And it's all written in Bella's perspective. It's first person narrative, right. So it's her telling her stories with Idis and I that all the way through. And she's an egotistical, moody bitch. She thinks she's better than everyone else and da-da-da-da. So when they brought this, and this is the character of Bellis, when they bring this in, Kristen Stewart did play the part that was written on the page because that's what her character is moody, thinks never she's smiles. Better than everyone else, never smiles, thinks she's God's gift to the human race and all this other stuff. And that's the character.
You can't fault her for playing the character that's written on the page.
Precisely. But she's kind of got that facade, though, through a lot of her movies. Although I do like her, but I mean, you know, she's very poker faced, kind of, I guess.
But then you look at Robert Pattinson, and I have to sit there and say, every time I see him, I think I probably in real life he probably smells musty.
Musty.
He just looks like he smells musty. You know, that kind of person just feels like they always wear like damp clothing all the time.
No.
I don't know why, but he just does. It's like, oh, he just looks musty.
Well, I can see if you're watching The Lighthouse, I'd get it.
But even in Batman, he's kind of like that kind of musty kind of.
Speaking of, I watched some of the 1956 Batman episodes. Do not waste any of your life, even on nostalgic reasons. That had to be some of the worst television I've ever seen in my life.
It wasn't for television, was it? Wasn't it for like the cinema? Wasn't it like their like little cliffhangers?
It's a series. That's all I know. It's on TV.
Yeah,
and the costume, his ears were his bat ears on his costume looked like, I don't know how to explain it, but he looks like a bug.
I don't know why I was thinking of Superman. You're right. The Batman. The Batman movies from the Batman serials from the 40s are awful. Yeah. But
they're funny. I have to admit, they're funny.
Fun. Like they don't even bring in like the real, like the Phantom, which is just a guy in a ski mask.
I didn't know those existed though until I was cruising through Tubi though 2 weeks ago, and I go, "What is this?"
I went through them during the first shutdown, and I remember like watching them and like. There was one of like the big henchman's name was Gabe, and I'm like, oh, okay, Gabe. Those great Batman villains. You got the Joker, the Riddler, Gabe.
Gabe. Right.
Kind of reminds me. It's like, have you ever seen that animated feature called Hoodwink? It's kind of piss take of
Red Riding Hood. I've heard of it, but I've not watched that.
And then, so you get like the White Rabbit, and he's like really evil. He's like an evil guy, and he goes to his henchman, and he goes, "What's your name?" He goes, "Keith." And like, we hired a Keith. Be scared of Keith. it's like, who named this henchman? You know, you gotta have a good henchman name. I think if you're gonna be a henchman, you gotta have that good henchman name, don't you? Like Gabe is like, "Well, what are you gonna do my taxes?"
Sean and I were discussing it when we were watching it because we would watch like one or two chapters a day, and then we'd be like the next day, like we're just sitting around or you know, like work is out, like we got nothing to do, everything's closed, like want to throw on the next installment of the Gabe arc. That's what we were.
I just didn't know they existed. I had no idea. Superman wasn't that bad, and that wasn't
the but Superman was for television. The Batman ones basically were for, they were fillers for what you did in those days in the 40s is you dropped your kids off on a Saturday and they would get like a cliffhanger and they would get like a little, you know, these little 15 minute episodes, and then what they do is they would end them on a cliffhanger so that way so the kids would have to come back next week to figure out what was going on. So and there's quite a few of those as well. I think there's also what's his name? There's Flash Gordon as well. That was around.
There's Captain Marvel. There's Captain America. They did all of them back then. But I remember one of them. They're ending on a cliffhanger. Like literally, Batman's I think about to go over the cliff. And like, come in for next week's episode. Robin saves the day. I'm like, what? Just a second ago, you were asking how is Batman going to get out of this, and then the title of the next episode is "Robin Saves the Day." Like, yeah. I figured this out.
God,
they're good at you. You stuck with it. I didn't, so I'll give you creds.
they're schlocky. Like don't go into them expect, like, even like in, even like compared to the 60s Batman, which is campy as hell, these are schlock. These are just pure schlock. That really is all I can describe them as. The Batmobile is just like a station wagon. It's not even like any...
Looks like a hearse. That's what it looks like.
Well, it does have. I mean, I've seen a couple of them, and it feels like Reefer Madness does Batman.
Exactly.
done through the lens of Ed Wood's budget.
Only what. And you even have Lyle Talbot in them, who is a regular Ned Wood movie. So that's actually only watch these if you really want to like laugh at just terrible filmmaking. Definitely. I mean, they're just awful.
I just looked up schlock, so that's definitely what it is. Schlock.
And you look,
low quality, and you look at these great, lacking quality.
And you look at these great films that are not available today because they've been destroyed, but yet they're still that roaming about.
No, but they can be found on Tubi.
Tubi has a lot of that stuff. Tubi has a lot of that stuff that it looks like no one else will touch.
Well, myself, I haven't been up to a lot recently. I've been I'm doing that whole winter television thing, so I got a lot to catch up on. I started watching season 2 of Warrior Nun and then realized like it's been like 2 years, so I've gone back to start watching season 1 just so I can remind myself what the hell is going on.
I had to watch at least the last one. It's sort of like you could tell that the years go by. I was watching Yellowstone and the little guy, he's a tall grown boy. I thought they replaced his character. And it's like, no, it's just the kid grew up. So, and all these women definitely changed in The Warrior Nun over the last 2 years. They've got a little more mature looking.
But I've been watching Dead to Me, which I'm really enjoying. Catching up on that because the new season starts of that. That's the one with Christina Applegate and Linda Castellini.
I had no idea she was so sick.
Yeah, this is her last season of it because she can't go back because of the multiple sclerosis. So.
God, that's so sad. Such a vibrant woman, too.
Yeah, and she was great. I mean, she won a Tony Award for Sweet Charity on Broadway. So, who would have thought, for Married with Children, you got someone that talented?
I had no idea until like the other day. She was getting her star on the Walk of Fame.
Yes.
Wait a minute, is she in a wheelchair?
Yes, it's so sad.
And she's not that old.
She's
50 something, isn't she? So
yeah, she's in her 50s.
But I mean, a friend of mine had multiple sclerosis, and I mean, it's like a 25-year disease. It's not quick. It is.
I've got a friend with one, and they're still going to the gym. They're still active. They still, they're fighting it. They're fighting it. You wouldn't even know they had it actually, because they're.
Well, my friend Rosalie. I mean, you know, she went from the stick, and then it kind of got bad, and then they're toward the end. I mean, it's like 25, 30 years of it, and the last 5 years were in bed. Sort of thing, and it's just kind of
sad.
Yeah, but and outside of that, I've been watching Ink Masters and a lot of trashy television like Sister Wives, which
Ink Masters better than Sister Wives. Sister Wives is total white trash.
Well, I have to sit there and say, I mean, I'm not going to sit there and bring this above any kind of award winning series, but I've been watching it since season 1, and we're in season 11. And one of them's left. One of the wives had left, and the other one's on her way out. So it's quite interesting to see this family dynamics like just fall apart. And it's just like, you know. But saying that, it's not one of those. It's not like a housewife program where everyone's yelling and screaming at each other. They're kind of really doing it. Everything is. The only one yelling and screaming is the guy because he's like, "How can they be doing this to me? And no one, they're not consulting me, and they're just leaving." It's like. So it's quite interesting from that point of view, especially like keeping, you know.
Which one got in trouble for? Didn't somebody get in trouble for molesting the children in one of these shows? Was it Sister Wives or was it a different?
No, it wasn't Sister Wives. The only bad thing that's happened in Sister Wives is the one of the wives or the first wife was catfished.
Oh, it was the one with all the kids. Oh my God, I can't remember the show. But
oh yeah, 16 and counting or something like that.
Something bullshit like that, yeah.
So no, I didn't watch that. But you know, I did watch this fantastic program where this English people who were living in Toronto decided to move to this really small town in Canada and bought this huge funeral home and redid it to live in. And it's like this huge mansion of a place. And it's, and they did a fantastic job. Most of
them
are.
If you remember the ones back home, they were all those big pillared mansions on the south side, you know?
Well, it's quite interesting because the thing is, the house is being taken in, and of course, people and everyone in this small town has, of course, had somebody's funeral at this place. So, yeah. So you get all the neighbors like, go, like, oh, I've looked through, you know, they're walking down the streets, like, I looked through your windows, looks like you guys are doing a good job. Because it's a town of 1,700 people.
That's, you know what you need to watch if you get a chance? I don't know if they're still doing it, but it's called Funeral Boss. And the last one they had was a Black family in Dallas, and that funeral home is still going. And they were doing, I mean, I just, my jaw was on the ground, some of these funerals that they were televising. I was like, they had some guy buried, he wanted to be buried in a barbecue pit. And I mean, yeah. It's just, what the fuck? But I mean, these people, they're funny. It's a funny family.
I mean, they haven't turned this funeral home, they turned this funeral home into a home sort of thing. So the embalming room is like a cigar room and,
I guess it shouldn't bother. People have died just about everywhere you've ever been or where you breathe. So, I mean, you know, you can't really avoid death no matter where you are. So,
wasn't that a line in Last Night in Soho? It's like, did anybody ever die in this house and
leave?
Yeah. What's her name? From the Avengers. It was like, yeah, Diana Rigg was like, this. Everyone has died in every single room in London, honey. You're going to have to deal with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that movie. Totally underrated movie, by the way.
That's very good. So outside of that, not a lot been going on. Work, it's dark here. Going to put up the Christmas tree this weekend, so yay.
All right. Yeah,
is that time of year?
Oh, my God, I know it's Christmas. We're almost to another Christmas again, guys. I can't believe that.
Yeah.
I could tell because I could see through the crack in my blackout curtains that there's like barely any light outside. I was like, oh, okay, it's officially the winter. It's officially getting close to winter.
Yeah, it's kind of cloudy here in Dallas.
I'm waking up and it's dark, and I'm coming home from work and it's dark. So there we go. So
daylight savings just sucks balls. I hope this is our last year. It really messes me up for weeks.
Well, that's what happens when you're old.
That's so damn right. You're just as old as me, dickhead.
Some of us have sold our soul to Satan that keeps us young.
Yes, you have. You did a long time ago.
And on that note, this brings us to The Women, which is a 1939 American comedy drama film directed by George Cukor. The film is based on Clare Boothe Luce's 1936 play of the same name and is adapted for the screen by Anita, Loos and Jean Murfin, who had to make film acceptable for the production code to be released. The film stars Norma Shearer, Joan Crawford, Rosalind Russell, Paulette Goddard, Joan Fontaine, Lucile Watson, Mary Boland, Florence Nash, and Virginia Gray. Marjorie Mann and Phyllis Povah also appear, reprising their stage roles from the play. Ruth Hussey, Virginia Welder, Butterfly McQueen, Teresa Harris, and Hedda Hopper also appear in smaller roles. Fontaine was the last surviving actress with a credited role in this film, and she died in 2013. The film contained an all-plays, all-female tradition. The entire cast of more than 130 speaking roles were female, set in the glamorous Manhattan apartments of high society evoked by Cedric Gibbons, and in Reno, Nevada, where they obtained their divorces. It presents an acidic commentary on the pampered lives and power struggles of various rich, bored wives and other women they come into contact with. Filmed in black and white, it includes 6-minute fashion parade filmed in Technicolor, featuring Adrian's most auteur designs, often cut in modern screenings. It has been restored by Turner Classic Movies. On DVD, the original black and white fashion show, which is a different take, is available for the first time and also on Blu-ray. Throughout The Women, not a single male character is seen or heard. The attention to detail was such that even in props such as portraits, only female figures are represented, and several animals which appeared as pets were also female. The only exception are a poster drawing of a bull in the fashion show segment, a framed portrait of Stephen Haynes as a boy, a figurine on Mary's nightstand, and an advertisement on the back of the magazine Peggy reads at Mary's house before lunch that contains a photograph of Douglas Fairbanks Jr. Other than that, they're the only male figures to be seen in the whole film. So what we're going to do is cut to the trailer of The Women and be right back.
Good grip on yourself, you're going to die. Stephen Haynes is stepping out on Mary.
But Sylvia, who told you? A manicurist?
What girl?
This Crystal Allen.
Crystal Allen?
Yes, you know, the girl who's hooked Mr. Haynes.
Hey, what happened to the hot date you had on for tonight, darling?
It's hotter than ever, dear. I'm having him dine at my place. About time he found out I was a home girl.
Home girl? Get her. Why don't you borrow the quintuplets for the evening?
Because I'm all the baby he wants, pet.
Now's your chance to go in there and put an end to this thing, Mary. Go in there and just say a few quiet words. Tell her you'll make Stephen's life an absolute tornado till he gives her up. Look where she was 6 months ago, and look where she is now.
Sylvia, will you please let me do what I want to with my own life?
You're very confident, aren't you?
Yes, because I know Stephen couldn't love a girl like you. Well, if he couldn't, he's an awfully good actor.
Cheer up, Sherry. Wait, you've lost as many husbands as I have. Married, divorced. Oh. L'amour. That's French for love.
You should have licked that girl where she licked you. In his arms. It's where you win in the first round, and if I know men, it's still Custer's last stand.
I've had 2 years to grow claws, Mother. Jungle red.
Hey, who are you to laugh, my pet? I've made good with my husband. Is that the way to talk to me after all I've done for you?
Oh, done what?
You didn't know a soul when you married Stephen. After all, it wasn't easy to put you over.
Stephen's fed up with you, Crystal, in your heart you know it.
Yes, take my advice, Crystal. Put your mind on your alimony.
Alimony? With what Stephen can get on you, he won't have to give you a dime.
Welcome back to the Lucile's podcast. We're discussing The Women from 1939, and starting with you, Joe. What are your thoughts of The Women?
Well, it's a film that I've wanted to see for a while because I've liked George Cukor since I first saw Philadelphia Story years ago. And the guy's, you know, he's fantastic. I love his version of Romeo and Juliet, Gaslight, David Copperfield, etc. He's a fantastic director. I also really love Rosalind Russell since I saw His Girl Friday. And I love when she's just a fast talk, like everything about her performances. I adore her in this and I adore her in His Girl Friday. She kind of plays the opposite here of what of the character that I grew to love, but she still kind of performs it in the same way. The fast talking, very snippy,
She's a troublemaker. Say it.
In this one, she is. Yeah, in this one, she's a total troublemaker. Nosy, I love it.
Gossipy troublemaker.
She's so catty in this. It's fantastic. I also recently started watching a lot of pre-code stuff. So I'd started seeing more of Norma Shearer. I saw Strangers May Kiss and a couple of other films with her. And I really, so this has been on my radar for a little while. I absolutely love this movie. It's funny. It's witty. It's very fast moving. It's 2 hours and 13 minutes and didn't feel like it. It was a breeze.
No, it didn't.
Performance wise, it's fantastic. I'm actually going to have to look up. I'm going to pull it up here because I don't want to get my, my characters confused. My character names confused. Absolutely love Joan Crawford as Crystal Allen. And I have to make sure that I don't get my Crystal Allen, Krista Allen, Sylvia Christie thing, Sylvia Crystal thing, all confused. All right, where was I? I'm losing myself in my.
You're
own.
Looking for your characters.
Oh, no, I pulled it all up so I could differentiate the characters. But yeah, I absolutely love Norma Shearer in this. She was really good in the 30s at playing like this kind of put upon woman who has to deal with in this case. Has to deal with finding out through the mechanisms of this
bitchy women's gossip.
Basically, yeah. That's I'm trying to avoid being the one saying it.
It's just, woman, I'll say it because this is typical women behavior. This is why I avoid large herds of women in any given moment. Right here.
The thing is between the two performances of Sylvia, which Rosalind Russell in this one, I kind of like her portrayal better. And I don't know
if she's funnier
because I just like Rosalind Russell better. But
like when she's doing those exercises.
Yes. I don't know how she's doing that. She's not a, like her legs are flapping like her mouth is. Like she does not shut up the entire thing. And I love her for it. But the way she portrays the character here is she will just put a little bomb somewhere and then just wait for it to go off. Whereas Sylvia in The Opposite Sex, and we'll get to that later, just straight up just tries to manipulate things. Rosalind Russell, though, the way she goes about things here, her performance, which is just, she's a lot sneakier, I feel like, or maybe she's not as obvious about it.
She looks innocent.
Yeah, whereas
it's her face. She looks like a deer, you know, or something with the big brown eyes. Yeah, with the hats.
Whereas in the other film, they went out of their way to make her look manipulative. But in this, she's kind of got a better face for this because she's a woman who, you know, you can see why somebody with this personality would still be married to somebody rich because she's very attractive.
I found the Rosalind Russell character quite interesting because at the end of the day, she talks about how great her relationship is with her husband, Howard Fowler, but it's basically all the stuff that she's doing is deflecting about her unsuccessful marriage, really. You know, it's all about deflecting. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to find out these things about other people. So that way it takes, no one's looking at me because I'm making them look at this way.
That's what I was kind of getting from this, that she's totally lacking in self-awareness in any way. She doesn't, she's absolutely manipulative and bitchy. And I love that about, she's so catty in this.
She's the kind of person that you would love having around just as long as it's not pointed towards you. She'd be a great hoot.
Yes. You can't tell her anything. You tell her.
Well, she's kind of a jealous, hateful in a competition with everybody. And she likes to diminish everybody around to elevate herself, kind of, maybe.
Well, yeah, because it's deflecting because at the end of the day, I mean, she doesn't have any children, does she?
No.
And she's talked about how great her marriage is, but we find out later that he's having an affair this whole time.
Yeah.
You know.
boy, how we find that out.
Yeah.
With Crystal's husband, with Crystal. I mean, she's double dipping all through all this whole movie, Joan Crawford.
Everybody is.
Yeah. Everybody, I mean, is. And I have to sit there and say, being the part of Norma Shearer, I think the hardest part to play in this would be Norma Shearer's part, because at the end of the day, the Mary Haynes part, because you have to be the straight person, you have to be the kind person, you have to be that, and you got all this mad, you got all this madness going around you, you have to be the sensible center. And I think that Norma Shearer handles that very, very well. But I also love, you know, Mary Haynes' mother. She is fantastic. Yeah. And some of the lines that she says is like, you know, when a woman gets older and she need, you know, and she's getting tired of herself, you know, she'll redo her
hair.
She'll change her hair or change the furniture or redecorate. But when a man gets tired of himself, he has to see himself through a younger person's eyes.
But do you know how they don't vilify the roving male in this movie? Look at the time. It's 1939. Women are basically not chattel still, but you can tell when we'll get to the other movie, but you can tell the difference culturally when we get to 1956, although we just inched along a little bit, you know, but I mean, you could still see it. Women, I mean, when you think about it, all these, like, encouraged the daughter, you know, the mother did, just to turn a blind eye to it and everything else. I mean, you could tell women still were not in a real position of power at that point, except for the one thing. You know,
another thing you have to remember is that we're also dealing with society at the moment, so socialites at the moment. So there's the, you know, there's the shame of being knocked out of your social circle. So there's that. And you got to remember, divorce wasn't legal at this time.
They went
to Reno because that's where the divorce, that's the only place you could get divorced.
The divorce capital of the world. I asked you about that because I didn't know anything about this Reno stuff. I knew divorces were hard to get, but I mean, they made them into vacations and holidays apparently. So they would go to Reno and have themselves because, a good old time while they're waiting.
Well, you had to go to Reno and it would take up to six to 12 weeks for your divorce to come through. So basically it's like you're there with a bunch of other women getting divorced, you know?
Divorcees were kind of, you know, remember watching Happy Days? This is the 50s. And what was that? What's her name? She used to play in General Hospital. She's one of the quartermaids. But the divorcee, and they were so looked upon, like, you know, ooh, a second-rate citizen, kind of sleazy, Louise-y kind of thing. But I mean, I was wondering, I mean, what the stigma would be being divorced in the 30s if it was so frowned upon in the 50s.
I think it also depends on where the money is held. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, these are socialite women, and they all, and it seems like, I mean, Mary comes from money anyway. Rosalind Russell, I think, comes from money. I think all these women come from money. The only poor person is Paulette Goddard's character. And she's kind of like in the middle of this, you know, the one that's like, I'm going to have a baby. And, you know, they have an argument.
Paulette Goddard, wasn't that Joan Fontaine's having the baby, or is it Paulette Goddard?
It's Joan Fontaine. Sorry. So it's Joan Fontaine's having the baby sort of thing. But at the end of the day, Joan Fontaine has her own money. Her husband doesn't. Because the whole reason why she's getting divorced, because she wants to get a car with her money, and he wants to buy a car, and he wants to wait to earn the money himself.
When I was looking at Joan Fontaine for this whole movie, I kept thinking Olivia de Havilland, because at the same time they were filming Gone with the Wind, you know, and I believe Stagecoach came out that year, Dark Victory with Betty Davis. I mean, those were all Oscar nominated movies, and they kind of, this one didn't really make it, and it should have.
Well, 1939 is considered the greatest year in the history of Hollywood.
Oh, Oscar.
Because of how many, like, just massive films that we still regard as some of the greatest ever made came out that year. So, yeah, this was up against the wall. I mean, this is Gone with the Wind, The Wizard of Oz.
Stagecoach.
Like I mentioned, Dark Victory, Stagecoach. Yeah. So
there was a lot going on that year. And that's why I was really surprised when the fashion show popped up. You know, I've never seen this before. So, I mean, I was like, oh, wow, color. What happened? We just land a house on somebody or what? But I thought that was a really nice touch, having the fashion show. I actually liked the clothes. What happened to classy dressing? Oh, my God, man. We just dressed like stupid.
But did you notice that once the fashion show happens and you see it in color, then for the rest of the movie, the rest of the characters are wearing those fashions?
That's true. I never know the hats and everything. I love the hats. Yeah. I totally adore the hats.
And the gold outfit. You know, and she ends up in the gold outfit. She's going, you know, jungle red.
I know the jungle red. Man, I'm half tempted to go get my nails done. Jungle red. I heard so much jungle red.
I love that line, especially at the very end. I absolutely love. Oh wow! I just got a Charlie horse. I just love the line at the end, which just I spent the last year learning how to get my claws jungle red.
Right.
Absolutely fantastic line, and it's in both movies.
What did you think about the way Joan Crawford and Cher kind of interacted? I was reading that they didn't really like each other. Did Joan Crawford get along with anybody?
Apparently not.
But you got to. I think you also have to remember that Joan Crawford's star was rising, and this is Norma Shearer's last movie.
Last movie, yeah. She kind of
She retired after this. But she
did a lot of strong feminine roles. But I mean, this was not a feminist kind of movement movie.
She was married to like one of the heads of MGM, Ira Trachtenberg. So
yeah, she didn't have to work anymore. I kind of feel like she really hit her stride in the early 30s with a lot of those great pre-code movies. I absolutely adore her in those.
She started out in silent films. When she realized that talkies were coming in, she went and took voice lessons and stuff like that to prepare herself for the talkies, where all the other ones were caught unaware. She was like ahead of the curve as well. Yeah. So
I mean, actually,
quite interesting her story.
That is interesting. I never would have thought.
Joan Crawford came along at the end of the silent era, so she was in The Unknown with Lon Chaney, I think, wasn't she?
Yeah.
I think she was like 17 or 18 in that movie. But man, in her younger days, wow, she was a stunner.
Yeah.
You could definitely she always had those eyes, but in this movie, yeah, you could really see how absolutely gorgeous she was.
Like what Elga says about her. Do you know Mrs. Haynes? Well, you know, Mr. Haynes goes in and she has those eyes that go up and down your searchlight. And then when you see her, it's like, yeah, good casting.
I gotta keep them separate because Joan Crawford is Crystal Allen in this, and we have Joan Collins
that's
as Crystal
right,
Allen in the
right,
second
yeah.
movie. So I gotta make sure I keep those separated too.
But I also think this film, as soon as it starts, it's like once you see like the animals compared to the women, sort of thing, and then I thought that was very, very clever. That they're introducing, you know, they show you all the actors and, you know, what their names are and what characters they're playing, sort of thing, against the animals, like, you know, Mary the Lamb and so on and so forth. And then as soon as the camera hits, it's like basically talk 100 miles per hour for everyone. It's like, whoa. Yes.
Yeah. Did you catch that one line from Joan Crawford, though? Crystal says, there's a name for you ladies, but it isn't used in high society. Outside a kennel.
Yes.
Some of the lines are quite race. I mean, the thing is that they had to put the screenwriter, Anita Loos, who would end up writing Gentlemen for Blondes, and another female they got to, you know, translate, but they had to be on the set because there are some lines that were too racy and they had to kind of keep finding a way to keep them racy but tone it down for the code at the same time, because there was a production code that they had to worry about.
Yeah.
So I mean, look at what she says. She goes, when Stephen Haynes sees me something he doesn't like, I'll just take it off. It's like, okay.
Oh yeah, Joe, you're saying about Rosalind Russell to play the part. She was being really whatever the way she acted, and it said George Cukor told Rosalind Russell told her to play the part very broad, because in this picture Sylvia is breaking up a family and there's a child involved, and if you're a heavy, her audiences will hate you. Don't play it like a heavy. Just be ridiculous. Instead, that that's way nobody hated her. Instead of, you know,
that's what happened here. She's like, you think about it, she is breaking up a family where there is a child involved, and Rosalind Russell is so charismatic that you can't hate her for it. She's still that charming. And as she says to as she says about Cary Grant and you know, his girl Friday, you know, she tells Ralph Bellamy when he says that Cary Grant's a really charming man. Well, it comes naturally. His father was a snake, and that's kind of that's kind of what she is here.
Joan Fontaine looks so innocent, though. Joan Fontaine, and she has such a potty mouth like her sister. And I'm sitting there thinking about how much her and Olivia de Havilland hated each other in 1939.
Well, she's like in her early 20s, I think, at this
point. She's really young in this, super young.
I mean, this film is just bitchy from the moment it starts to the time it finishes. I mean,
well, none of these women are role models, except maybe Norma. She kind of a role model.
But you know, the thing is,
her husband want, and you know, and it's just it that they all it's all about pride. If you notice, the theme is the women trying to keep their pride throughout this whole movie.
But the thing is that there's a lot of criticism based about like on the standard of the women. But if you look at it, the women are the strong characters, and the men that they're married to are tend to be the weak ones. I mean, Stephen Haynes is weak,
right? Oh, but they don't show him though. You don't have any context for any of the men.
But that's what I like about this movie, because you're seeing everything through their eyes, and they're making you see everything through their eyes. And so you're imagining everything through them and what they're saying, and it's their point of view. And that's what I like about this movie, because the thing is, and the thing, another thing about this movie that I've seen this movie so many times, because it's one of those movies that the first time I saw it, I had to see it again, because you miss out so much because it's so fast paced anyway.
Yeah.
And then the more times you watch it, and you just find yourself just laughing all the way through it by the end of it. And even the melodramatic moments are like very milked up, you know, it's like,
except for the cat fight. Daddy, cat fight with Paulette Goddard and
Rosalind Russell.
Yeah, oh my God, they're slapping each other.
But look at the lines that Marjorie Mann says.
Yeah.
You know, about her, you know, her redheaded husband. That's
like... She's great in this.
I mean, that was the other thing, because the whole time I'm sitting there watching and going, where's Marjorie Mann? I haven't seen her. And they show up in Reno at this ranch. And of course, Marjorie Mann is going to be the woman running the ranch.
Of course.
Who else are you going to have in 1939 playing that role?
I mean, and she played that. She played that part on Broadway.
I didn't know that until you mentioned it in the build up here. So
you
know,
did you notice it had 666 live performances before?
I noticed that at the beginning.
Did you see that? I'm just going, I wonder if they did that on purpose. 666 live performances before, whatever. It just caught my eye.
It didn't actually run that long, so I mean, there's that. But I kind of wonder if they were. If that really like toyed with the really religious people who probably would not have wanted to see this movie anyway.
Well, it looks it just hit. I mean, you're watching the credits because I was wanting to see who was, you know, everybody that was in it. And then I saw that 666 live performances on Broadway and I was laughing. It's like, that is just such a fucked up number to just stick in there. Okay. So somebody had a sense of humor and someone was just fucking with somebody. I don't know, but it was a nice little touch.
No, I mean, it ran for 3.5 years.
666,
exactly.
Yeah. That brown number.
It's just strange that they would put the number there, because I don't really see that.
Like, well, it is a big 666.
Actually, they do that in a couple things. The Bad Seed talks about how many performances it had on Broadway in its credits. And Arsenic and Old Lace does it.
I just picked up the DVD of The Bad Seed. I haven't watched it yet. I'm really
I love that movie.
I love The Bad Seed. It's one of my all-time
favorites. I love Mervyn LeRoy's work in the old gangster pictures in the 30s. So, and I didn't realize he made a horror movie. And I'm like, wait a second. The director of Little Caesar and the Five Star Final and all these movies that are just fantastic movies made a horror movie in the 50s. Yeah. I can't wait to see that.
He's a child in the pits of hell.
We did that as our book to screen. We read the book and then did the film as well.
The book's great too, actually. The book's really good.
Yeah.
I cannot wait.
What would you give me for a basket of kisses? I'll give you a basket of hugs. I hit her with my shoes.
I'm looking up there at all my Mervyn LeRoy movies. I haven't put the DVD up there yet because I'm not going to put it up there until I'm done. But I'm like, it's going up there with all my films by Mervyn LeRoy. I absolutely love him. So I
Bad Seed is, you know, there are a couple black and white films that I can't live without. And The Women, The Bad Seed is another one. I just put them on every time I see them.
Wuthering Heights. I can't live without Wuthering Heights.
The Olivier Wuthering Heights?
Yes.
I love that version too.
And the movie Bad Seed, almost everyone in that movie was in the original Broadway production.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that was originally a stage play either. Well, at least until you just mentioned it now that they put it on at the beginning. I cannot wait to see that. I will let you guys know what I think of it as soon as I see it.
Yeah, please do. I love that.
They even do curtain calls at the end of the Bad Seed.
Oh, do they?
Oh, yeah, that's right. They do.
I'm looking forward to that. I actually recently rewatched Arsenic and Old Lace. I think I threw it on that movie too.
Cary Grant is hysterical. I love it.
I love Arsenic and Old Lace. The only regret I have of that is that when Arsenic and Old Lace was on Broadway, it was the person, what's his name? He played Frankenstein. Boris Karloff was on Broadway doing that role.
He couldn't do the movie.
He couldn't do the movie, so they got Richard Massey in. But Richard Massey asked, was it okay if he played the part? And Boris said, yeah, I'm sorry, but I can't do this. And it would have been great if they could have got Boris in for that movie, because everyone else is from the Broadway.
There was a TV version in the 60s where they got Karloff to play Jonathan Brewster. I cannot for the life of me find it. I'm wondering if it might be lost. It was like on one of those like Schlitz Playhouse Hours or whatever. Yeah, it probably isn't anywhere Mercury near Playhouse as good. There's a version of Arsenic and Old Lace in the 60s where they actually paid for television. And it was one of those series where it was like they just did a live performance on television. Boris Karloff actually played Jonathan Bruce. But I cannot for the life of me find it. I will see if I can. I absolutely want to see it. And I guarantee TV it's nowhere movie, near IMDb. As good.
Let me see.
Yeah, it is a TV movie. Yeah.
It's on YouTube.
Is the full movie on YouTube? I could not find it on YouTube.
1962. Who's in it? Who'd you say was it? Oh, wait. That looks like Cary Grant, though. No, that's 1944. So this one is 1962. Yeah. Arsenic and Old Lace.
Did you actually just find the 60s? Send me the link if you found it, because I do want
to
check it out.
I'm trying to think if it's the right one.
It'd be the one with Boris. It would say Boris Karloff in the titles. So, but yeah, I mean, so there's a lot of like stage plays that they were actually bringing at this time.
I think this is what you're looking for.
Like the Little Foxes. That was another stage show that they brought to the screen, and which is, I mean, and I mean, it does show, because what you have is these fantastic lines going at 100 miles per hour with the women, sort of thing. And I have to sit there and say that everyone is keeping up with everyone else as well, which must have been a hard thing to manage. I imagine there's probably some trouble on the set with this one.
Maybe. Was there a lot of ad-libbing on this, or was it all just straight from the screenplay?
Well, they didn't ad-lib in those days. Basically, you learned your lines, and you memorized your lines, and you went for it.
Sort of like Dark Shadows.
Yeah, except you know, these.
I know with His Girl Friday, which was a couple years after this, Howard Hawks let Rosalind Russell and Cary Grant ad lib as much as they wanted, because they were just so fantastic at it. Maybe in this case, you might not have had people who were that good at just ad libbing like that, but and this thing, Rosalind Russell, I feel like she steals every scene she's in. I love Norma Shearer, as much as I love Joan Fontaine, as much as I love Marjorie Main. I mean, even when
the Countess, I love her too. I mean, she's so much.
Who's the Countess in this one? I know the other one was Agnes Moorehead. The Countess in this one was
L'Amour.
And I love that. That's the introduction of, or that's the reintroduction of Sylvia in this one. Who
Mary
said
Boland?
L'Amour?
Yeah.
Mary Boland. He goes, and she goes, you know, and you know, you tried to poison me, but it didn't work. Lamar, Lamar, Lamar. He goes, we went skiing and he pushed me over the cliff. And Lamar, Lamar, Lamar. That was my third husband.
This one's a lot more dialogue driven. But it's still visually, it's fun. Hold on, telemarketer. I'm looking at the cast and something
towards the end though, when Norma Shearer is like going like this into the screen with her arms outstretched. It's like, come on, they could have done something better with that scene. I'm sorry.
I like that because that ties in with her whole. I mean, the reason why I like that because the first time I saw it, I go, this is wacky.
But it is.
The more times I see it, I realize it's not as wacky because if you look at her, she's the melodrama of everything. Everything's true. Oh, mom, I don't want to leave him. Oh, and even her dog is melodramatic.
It was so 1920s, though.
It kind of suits her because her whole character's like that. You know, her co-character's kind of like
she's a martyr, basically, is what she is. She's a murdered woman that's dealing with the mistress. And then, you know, the mother says, well, if you divorce him, he's going to marry this, you know, shop girl or whatever. You know, I just love how, if the guy was a billionaire, I would definitely turn a blind eye. Millionaire, yeah, I would turn a blind eye. You know, I'm not stupid. But I mean, you know, you kind of, they were supposed to be married for 10 years. They got this perfect marriage and he's that weak. You know, he goes for a shop girl, but, you know, men. My mother explained infidelity to me that it's just men, just it's an affliction. Mm. Men just have an affliction they can't
help. Mm.
If you look at every relationship, though, they say that 93% of all relationships, the men does stray at some point.
Yeah.
Still, that's the statistics today.
Today, 93%. Women on the other women are not innocent. I know everybody wants to feel sorry for the oppressed feminist, but they're no better than most men. Let me tell you.
But let's put it this way: 68% of all marriages end in divorce now.
Yeah, well, it's because nobody wants to go in it for the long haul, you know.
I mean, an interesting thing about this production is that F. Scott Fitzgerald helped work on an early version of the script.
When was the script written? The 20s?
The play was probably, I mean, I think this must have come hot on the heels of the play. Because the thing is that they tried to get almost all of the Broadway cast back to do the movie.
Right.
Marion Davies played the Rosalind Russell part on Broadway. They tried to get her back, but she just signed a contract with 20th Century, so they couldn't get her, so Rosalind Russell stepped in. So
she said that Cukor made her comedian that she was, because she said what I was reading is that she was really worried about being hated. But then she learned how to be so slapstick, and she just took it and ran from there, which I didn't know until I just read that, by the way, that that's what happened. She really counts him with her comedian talent through the years.
I could see that. And I mean, Cukor was,
he was a woman's master. Director as well. That's what he's known for.
They did say that he was one of the few men that could handle that ensemble of women from Hollywood, especially all of them.
Cukor was known as like the woman's director. If you're a woman actress, you wanted to be with Cukor because Cukor knew how to manage you and film you and stuff like this. I mean, when Cukor was asked about the strategies for managing a cast of 135 women led by three famously demanding stars, he described one technique for dealing with procedures. He made sure that all three stars were called to the set simultaneously, either by sending separate staff to knock on their dressing room doors on identical moments or by calling ready ladies so all could hear and they would all come to the set. So he had to make sure that it was done simultaneously so you wouldn't have to deal with
all the egos. So he had to choreograph calling them on set?
Yeah.
So, it's Crawford. Who are the other two that were notoriously demanding? Was Norma Shearer?
Norma Shearer probably was at that time.
Paulette Goddard was too. She used to be a Ziegfeld Follies girl, I think.
Yeah.
And she was kind of kind of.
Rosalind Russell was riding a wave at this time as well, so she might have been.
Maybe she was, yeah.
Well, everybody knows Joan Crawford was probably high maintenance.
Oh, Joan Crawford was the one that I knew instantly as one of the high maintenance.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have to tell me.
I feel so bad for Joan Crawford. Even in death, she still gets it, you know? Yeah.
I mean, but she doesn't... She gets it because that was her personality and that was who she was. She was known as just being an asshole. You know, she was just mean to everybody, thought she was the greatest thing that ever walked. And I mean...
She's known as being hard as nails anyway. I mean, Joan Crawford. She slept her way to the top.
The tension was between Norma Shearer and Joan Crawford. They repeatedly told the story of one day the two actresses were running lines to prepare for their big dressing room confrontation. Apparently, George Cukor filmed the master shot, then lined up a close-up of Norma. While he rehearsed her, Joan Crawford, who still brought her knitting to the set, clacked away at an afghan with her large, heavy needles. He asked her to stand behind the camera during the take and speak her lines off screen to Norma. She did so, trailing her afghan. Norma lost her concentration, looked up sharply, and asked Jones to stop needling during the retake. So apparently he made Crawford apologize, but she didn't want to, refused to walk off the set.
But she didn't change much, did she, Joan Crawford?
No,
what was she doing during Whatever Happened to Baby Jane and Hush Hush and Charlotte? She was always knitting in the background.
Well, see, I didn't know that was one of her character flaws. I just never expected Joan Crawford to knit, you know? But apparently she just sent a telegram apologizing. She didn't do it in person. She sent a telegram.
But she's done that in like every single film that she's done, hasn't she? I mean, that's in like the feud she's doing now, all that stuff at the same time. So it's like
the thing is when you're 17, 18 years old and you're being already touted as like the most beautiful woman in the world and like this fantastic performer and everything, like she was, you know,
she was an actress.
What's that?
She was a great actress. There's no doubt.
She was. I'm never going to deny Joan
Crawford. But what a bitch.
But when you're having your head swelled like that, when you're 17, 18 years old, and you're on camera, like I think her first movie might have been The Unknown. I don't know if it was her first. But one of her first movies, she's sitting there with, you know, probably the, you know, aside from Charlie Chaplin, probably the biggest star of the time. So, yeah, you're holding your own with him and you're the love interest in his movie, you're going to get a swelled head. So yeah, you know, 10, 12 years later, you know, of course.
And your movies are keeping the studio afloat.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, sort of like if Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, she didn't like laying down. If you lay down, I don't care what you got, your tits go to the side. I don't care how old or young you are. But she wanted those push up the things to stick the falsies. So when she was laying on the beach during her last scene, her boobs were sticking up and not going to the side.
Was that really?
Joan Crawford, she kept coming out with different sized tits through the whole show.
But I mean, another thing you have to remember about Joan Crawford as well is that everything was for her fans. And she would sign 150 to 200 photographs of herself to send for her fan mail. She would answer her fan mail. She didn't have a secretary answer it. She would answer them herself.
Well, that's commendable. It's so, definitely commendable.
And it was all about her fans and her fan and being loyal to her fans and showing that this is what her fans want. And you know, because of that, that's what made her a star, because she was so loyal to them, they would go and see every single film that she did. Sort of thing. And
she could walk into it.
Yeah. And the thing is another thing is Joan Crawford was considered a movie star. She wasn't considered an actress, she was a movie star.
What do you guys think the difference is? A movie star
is someone who basically sleeps their way due to the casting couch, is what Joan Crawford did, and an actress is someone that Hollywood comes contact calling your name.
You sure that's just not Broadway? ugly Hedda Hopper gossip or
Joan Crawford made a porn.
Did she?
She lost her virginity at the age of 12 to her uncle, and she said it was the highlight of her life.
Stepfather. I thought it was a stepfather.
That was the highlight of her life.
She was 12.
Because she said, she goes, that he was the only person who ever showed love to her.
Yeah. She had kind of a messed up life.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm sorry I left at the comment now that she said it was the highlight of her life. I didn't realize it was
going to be. I wouldn't say it was the highlight of her life.
That's what she said. It was the highlight of her life because it's the only time she felt love.
Yeah, she did say that. I didn't hear the highlight part.
But the thing is,
but movie stars. So you're saying, okay, Vivian Leigh slept her way up to the top.
Leigh was an actress. There's a difference because there's two ways that you can make it in Hollywood. You like made it through your acting, and then basically,
right?
You know, this is the casting couch, and this is the problem with this is what caused the feud between Joan Crawford and Betty Davis.
Okay, yeah, you're right.
Betty Davis was the actress, and Joan Crawford was the movie star. Yeah. And everybody wanted to sleep at Joan Crawford. But when Betty Davis was there, the directors and movie households go, she's a great actress, but I would never, with that face, I would never want to sleep with her.
I felt so sorry for Betty Davis when they'd say shit like that. You know, Hollywood being so Me Too and so feminist, they still treat women like slabs. Thrown on. I mean, they just do. I mean, old Hollywood was awful. They were brutal to women.
When you're an actress by the age of 30, you were being cast aside.
You're over the hill. Not to mention, I was reading a bunch of stuff about how I was reading about Errol Flynn, how they were trying to think all the gay romances that were going on. I mean, there was so much stuff. That's when press and everybody really kind of protected the stars back then. Not so
well,
much now.
Yes, yes,
fixers.
Huh?
Well, it's Fixers? Yes and no. It's yes and no. If your star was high, you were protected. If your star was falling, then they might trade your story off for someone whose star is rising. So it would depend on what was going on when your star is at high. You know, right. Like Errol Flynn, why he was going great, it was fine. He was protected. But as his star fell...
He drank all the time. He was always
fun. Well, the thing is, he was drinking all the time when his star was up. But because his star was falling, it's like, okay, well, I'll tell you what. They did it to Rory Calhoun. That's what happened to Rory Calhoun. Yeah. Rory Calhoun was up here sort of thing. And then when he made a couple of dud films and started going, they traded his story for someone
Montgomery
else.
Montgomery Clift.
So basically Montgomery Clift became the protected one, and they sold Rory Calhoun down.
Then they sold Montgomery Clift down the shitter too. But I believe that, Elizabeth Taylor put him under one of her wings. She was trying to save him or whatever. She's trying to save everybody though.
He was quite self-destructive anyway. So
with Errol Flynn, supposedly, and I still don't know if this is true, he was supposedly a Nazi sympathizer, and they covered that up.
So was Hedda Hopper, they said.
That is.
Hedda Hopper had a little blacklisting issue back in the 30s as well, for early 40s.
Well, Errol Flynn's party trick at the time, which is very well rumored, and basically because he was extremely endowed, he liked to go behind people and whip it out and run it down there, and it would and hang it over their shoulder, and it would hang down over their shoulder. And he goes,
Was he standing on a ladder? Because I'm trying to get a visual here, okay?
No, the person.
People sitting on a couch, I'm assuming.
Okay, yeah, I was going to say, holy shit. Yes.
Yeah, apparently he's very well endowed, and that's what he is known for. But was it Rudolph Valentino or the other one?
Valentino got killed by his lover, didn't he?
Yeah, with a silver dildo.
What? That's not what I heard. Okay, now you got to tell me because I don't want to look it up.
I think it was either Rudolph or the Navarro. Navarro, one of the sheiks. One of them was stabbed to death in this great big...
What male actor died by a silver dildo?
There was apparently a screen test prank. Old Hollywood lore. I don't know if it ever really happened. Where supposedly either John or Lionel Barrymore, I don't remember which one it was
Navarro.
Screen testing. Huh?
Navarro, that was it.
Well,
it was Navarro. With the silver dildo.
This is again how John, it was either John or Lionel Barrymore was screen testing John Carradine. And this is, again, the racy humor. And we still to this day, no footage exists. We don't know. But right. The screen test basically told Carradine to walk out from the side of the stage and have a giant smile on his face, wipe his face and rub his stomach like he just had the greatest meal of his life.
Really?
And John Carradine, during the screen test, supposedly walks in from the side of the stage, looks around, pats his stomach, giant smile, wipes his face, doing all this, just going really over the top with it, then walks off the stage. And then whichever one of the Barrymores it was walks out from the stage behind him and zips up his zipper.
Did not know that. Well, Raymond Navarro, apparently he was so enamored with Rudy Valentino. What was it? Rudy Valentino? Did I say that
Rudolph
right?
Rudolph Valentino.
That I guess he had a signature signed silver dildo. I'm still trying to figure out what happened with said dildo.
I find it ironic that in the movie about the gossiping old women, we're all sitting here gossiping about old Hollywood.
Well, you don't tell me, you guys know better to tell me a story that somebody died from the silver dildo signed by Rudolph Valentino and not expect me to be curious.
But there are like so many old Hollywood stories. They're so kind of tragic, but they're so tragic. There's something kind of funny about them. It's like the old actress, Ida Lupino. What's her name?
Loopy Velez.
Velez. I mean, how she died. I mean, you know, she called this press conference, and then she's, you know, because she wanted to be this beautiful corpse. So she eats this rich meal, you know, decorates, you know, with, you know, rose petals and everything like this. And then, you know, she overdosed, you know, she takes all her pills and eats this meal. Well, of course, what happened is because the rich meal didn't mix with the pills, what happened is, and she's in this, well, kind of worse than that. And she's in this great big long flowing nightgown that they hope to be found in. So she gets in a druggy stupor, going, she has to throw up. So she's making her way to the bathroom, trips over her negligee, hits her head on the toilet and drowns in the toilet. So when the press people showed up, this is how they find her.
Yeah.
Oh my God. What a
You've never heard Hollywood. That
Why does anybody want to live in Hollywood? I mean, it just sounds like there's nothing ever happy and Hollywood happy.
No, I mean,
the misery.
Well, look at the one who liked to wear the long scarves all the time. And then basically she liked to wear these long scarves, and I can't remember her name, but she's, you know, she'd be driving down the cliffs with these long scarves. And this is what she's known for. Very beautiful. And of course the long scarf gets caught up in the wheels of the car and decapitates her. So that's the last thing you see of her. So, you know,
yeah, there's a whole thing of celebrity deaths. You know, now I've got something
Fatty Arbuckle being charged with raping someone with a Coke bottle that kills the woman.
Oh, I didn't know that. Well,
that's what ruined his career. So,
well, and I mean, so. I know everybody knows somebody, you know, or someone that's occupied Hollywood or great the halls of Hollywood. But why is it so? Why are they such social deviants?
Because, but the thing is, I think it's not that they're social deviants. I think the simple fact is that when you have money, you can get away with anything, isn't it?
Thus becoming a social deviant.
Yeah, I mean, but the thing is, we have it today in big business anyway. I bet you Bill Gates. I bet you Bill Gates is probably there's some deviation going on there as well. Or
money isn't promoting cricket flour for the rest of us peasants, D.
You know, and I'm sure that old man that married Anna Nicole Smith didn't hire her for her personality.
Oh, definitely.
Well, everybody knew that, and she didn't marry him because he was like the love of her life. So everybody knows.
But what I'm saying is that money talks, and money can pretty much buy anything you want, and can actually hush a lot of things up as well.
True.
And
that.
Interesting enough, as we go through this whole gossip thing, and this whole movie's about gossip, you do realize you play the gossip columnist in this movie, don't you? That's Hedda Hopper.
Yeah.
So
had no idea that she'd been in some movies before that. She was an actor before that. I had no idea about that until I started reading up on the movie.
Well, she does appear in a lot of movies, but she always happens to be the gossip columnist in movies. So
she had those famous hats, you know, the hats she always wore.
Yeah. Well, there's two of them. There's Hedda Hopper and there's the other one as well. And they were kind of in competition with each other sort of thing.
For destroying people's lives.
They could destroy your life or they could make it. So it all depends if what, you know. But at that time, you have to remember this is before social media and everything went out through their columns.
And I remember the National Enquirer used to always be by the stand when you're on your way out of the grocery store. You see all those crazy, I mated with a space alien and had all of his babies.
that was the National Enquirer. That was the other one. That was
Star.
Weekly World News.
That was even worse.
The Midnight Star, the something Midnight. That was even worse than the other ones.
But these guys.
I had Elvis's baby. It's like so many people had Elvis's baby when he died.
Or when Anna Nicole Smith died, everybody wanted to be the father of that child. Remember that shit that went on when she died? Oh my God. Tangent City. Here we go again. Okay.
Or Bat Boy found. A human Bat Boy.
Bat Boy was found so many times.
Oh my God, Bat Boy. I forgot all about that.
But these gossip columns would be more like akin to like Page Six on the New York Post. You know, like the Hollywood gossip thing is more like what the Hedda Hopper character is doing in this.
And we still have this alive today, but now we have it through YouTubers.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the drama that goes. TMZ, that's what TMZ is. So things haven't really changed that much. Is that we just get it a lot quicker now. So we get it like 5 minutes after it happens.
Well, I mean, nothing's sacred anymore. They don't even try to protect anything about their privacy. I mean,
because now it's going to, somebody could just go on Twitter and it breaks in 30 seconds.
Yeah.
You know, whereas, you know, back then, what was the name? Was it Hail Caesar was the name of the movie? Where they had the character that was the Hollywood fixer that would kind of go around and stop stories from breaking.
I'm sure that person actually probably lived.
Or in this, it's probably like in this period, kind of like LA Confidential, where you had the Danny DeVito character. You know, that's more akin to what it was in this.
Well, this LA Confidential is pretty much all based on this. I actually just finished. Was sent a book about a biography on James Ellroy and about his life and his career and everything like that. I mean, it does go in a lot of detail, but most of the stuff that he writes about, like the Black Daily and stuff like that, he was living in LA at that time. His mom was murdered in a fashionable way.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And he was, and his father discovered Rita Hayworth when she was a 13-year-old and her parents are selling her off for, sex favors.
They did her dirty, boy.
Yeah, and then they raised her to be, and then she becomes Rita Hayworth by the time she got to the studio, and she's very talented. But his father was like her manager for a while when she became Rita Hayworth, sort of thing, but discovered her when she was performing these little seedy nightclubs in Mexico. So it's like, but I mean, you know, so LA Confidential and Black Dahlia, I mean, there's a lot of truth in there. It's fictionalized truth is what turns up. So that LA Confidential and all those thingies, I mean, you know, Tab Hunter's career was ruined by that kind of magazine and people like the tabloids, by those tabloids. And as I said before, they would sell a person off and to protect someone else off. Like, well, we don't want you to talk about Eddie Fisher, but I'll tell you what. Taff Hunter sucking off guys in the back row. We'll give you that story because his last movie didn't make that much money. And that's what they were doing.
I believe it. Yeah. How sad. You know,
that's the reason why Cary Grant was always protected, because luckily for Cary Grant, his star never actually went down at all. So, you know, him and Randolph Scott were pretty much, you know, who know? I mean, they're pretty close. They'd lived together for quite a few years, but nothing ever came out about them after their death. Stuff started coming out, but not when they were alive. So, but we get that in high society now anyway. I mean, I guess high society for us nowadays would be the Kardashians or anyone on those Real Housewives programs. You know, the thing is like, you know, chances are, it's like, you know, they walk out of the bathroom and they got toilet paper hanging out of their backside, it makes the news, you know, because this is society. This is what, and these are the people we aspire to be. So it's like, so things haven't changed that much from the women, really.
No, I mean, like I said, when you get into the second movie, you see that we kind of inched up a little more, culturally speaking, but not a whole lot in 20 years.
Yeah.
I wonder, was there a more recent remake of this that,
They did a remake in the 2000 and something.
2016, 20 years, it was around then. Yeah,
it was with Deborah Messing, Annette Bening, Meg Ryan, and people of that ilk. Bette Midler's in it.
Yeah, I haven't watched that one.
It's really hard to do because they try to make them all as friends, and it kind of misses that bite. Mm-hmm.
These guys are very believable friends, except for maybe Sylvia, you know.
But I mean, but they love having Sylvia around because Sylvia makes them laugh.
I was gonna say until that moment where she's getting her nails done and she finds that the story Sylvia is telling people is about her husband and Crystal Allen. Mm-hmm. So that's,
I mean, the only voice of reason is Mary Haynes's mom. She's the voice of reason in this movie. You know, whatever you do, don't tell your girlfriends anything. You know what I mean? And as soon as she tells her girlfriends anything, it all you know, it just comes all, makes it all worse. And, you know, and I hate to say it, but, you know, I find this behavior that happens during this movie does get repeated today. I can always, because, you know, when I'm generalizing here, so, you know, if you're gonna send hate letters, just remember I'm generalizing. But I can tell you right now that when I go into the office, and if a female does climb up the ladder, it's the other women sitting there saying that she slept her way to the top. It's never a man saying that. Oh, she's sleeping her way to the top, and that's how all the women are speaking about her, because it's kind of an odd kind of a thing that happens. Or I can always tell which one's missing in the office by who they're bitching about, and I'm just like, okay. It's just kind of a weird dichotomy that happens with a group like that sort of thing. And, you know, any kind of bad news is like, they all get excited about it. You know, they're like, oh, isn't this awful? Da, 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 da. It's like, okay. You know, I have friends' moms that basically is like, I remember my ex, you know, she's like, she comes home from work. She goes, I feel ill. And she's doing this whole camellia act on the sofa. She has this bit of gossip. She tells us this bit of gossip, all very animated and excited about it. Talk about how horrible something happened to some person in the neighborhood. And then afterwards, she's like, oh, I feel ill, and goes back down for a nap. It's like, what the hell is this? You know, I mean, but then saying that doesn't necessarily mean this happens all the time. But, you know, there is this kind of cattiness that goes on sometimes with
the females. Yeah, I think it's more of a jealousy thing. Like, yeah, like everyone wants to perceive if somebody's doing better than them that there's a reason for it. And the reason's never that person's just better at it than me.
Yeah. So, you know, it is what it is, sort of thing. It is, you know, and it's gossip anyway. Anytime that you're dealing with gossip is, you know, gossip is what gossip is. You can either partake in it, listen to it, or ignore it. So that's, you know, this is a movie about gossiping. You know,
there's one person who used to work at my job who was the gossip that would tell everybody everything. And he lowered his schedule down to where he only works like every couple of months now because he's got a different job. And he keeps coming back every couple of months just to stay on the roll so that he's not, you know, he doesn't have to reapply. So what he came in one day and he straight up asked me what the gossip is. So I gave him the wrong information on everybody, who's hooking up with who. I was just like, oh yeah, this person's sleeping with this person now. This person's doing this with this person now.
I love doing that to people, especially if you know they're gossip. Just feed them full of bullshit and just watch them hang themselves. I just love it.
And I loved it because I was telling all the people that I was like, oh yeah, I told them this, and this, and watch the story gets out now. And sure enough, it all started to, like, yep, there you go.
Yeah, I always do that with people I first meet anyway, if I don't know much about them. And what I'll do is I'll give them a little bit of information about myself that's not 100% true or whatever like this, and just sit back and see how far it goes. It's like, and then if it doesn't go anywhere, it's like, okay, fine.
Yeah.
If it goes everywhere, it's like, I'm not telling this person anything. So it's like, ever. So. But, you know, I always find that if you're gossiping about other people, so and, you know, I take it myself, I kind of was brought up with my mom saying that if they're talking about you, they're leaving someone else alone. So I don't care if they're talking about me. So, and I find that if you know, when it happens to gossip, I'm just like, okay, not interested.
My whole thing with gossip is if they're giving me gossip about somebody, then they are going to be, I can't tell them anything because I know that whatever I tell them is going to be.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So you gotta know to keep those people, at arm's length at all times.
I mean, I don't gossip because I'm just too self-involved in myself.
But basically, you can't say that most of these women are role models because they're not really, but they're just.
I would tell you though, if these people were real, I would be hanging around Sylvia Fowler because I would just be laughing the whole time.
Yeah, I could see that.
I would never tell her anything, but I would love to sit next to her at a dinner party because she would just be like,
and I mean,
be like a
I mean, Mary's the smart one, man, because throughout the entire movie, you have Hedda Hopper's character saying, "Oh, I know I'm not going to get anything from you." She's tight-lipped and the smartest person in the room. And unfortunately, you know, it's the worst person for this whole kind of series of events to unfold on.
Mm-hmm. But at the same time, she does come out on top of it all sort of thing.
She does. You know? She does.
And to be honest, even when she does come on top and basically they need to, she needs this story to come out. She's not the one that tells Hedda Hopper the story.
Not in this version.
No.
Yeah.
I thought that was very, very clever. She gets someone else to do it for her.
Right.
Yeah.
Always get somebody else to do it. Don't get your hands dirty. It works for me.
And that kind of tells you a bit how Mary operates, though, at the same time. You know, I'll be quiet. I'll sit here. I'll let people tell me anything. But at the same time, you know that no one ever tells Mary anything unless they're with other people. She never has one-on-ones with anyone.
Well, they didn't really, I guess they had their little tiff where she pulls Paulette Goddard off the horse and they start fighting and rippy. I like the cat fight parts. I always thought those were funny.
Yeah.
I still love L'Amour. Who said L'Amour as Sylvia walks onto the ranch? I love that. That reintroduction of her here. And then eventually the cat fight where she looks over at Paulette Goddard as it says in the news that she's being renovated.
Renovated.
So on a scale of 1 to 5, how many stars would you give the women, starting with you, Vix?
Oh, absolutely a 5. Look at all look at the powerhouses they got for acting in it. You're not going to get that again. That's a once in a lifetime movie, actually, when you think about it. All them gathered together like that, you know, and then you have the director that they have to actually be able to direct all these women and knows how to keep them all compartmentalized. I mean, it's an excellent film. If you don't laugh at this, I mean, it's just great. I mean, it's got everything, you know, except for really romance. There's just lots of cheating. There's no romance.
What about yourself, Joe? How many stars do you rate it?
5 on this one. I absolutely adore this movie. I went in already a fan of, you know, Marjorie Main, Rosalind Russell, Norma Shearer. So I already went in liking the cast. I love George Cukor's movies. So as a first time watch, I'm definitely going to watch it again. I don't know when that's going to be. but I will definitely, this will definitely fall into my rotation of movies I revisit. Because like Keith said, you're laughing and then you're missing jokes while you're laughing. That's how fast all the dialogue in this movie is and how fast it all comes flying. And
it rotates around a spa too. They're all pampered, spoiled little witches is what they are.
it really is. I mean, and you know, you maybe like Vicky said, the women in this movie aren't exactly, you know, feminist role models. You can't really. And
I'm just talking about as being human role models because they're so catty to each other, basically. Feminism really hadn't started yet, really. This was a product of it, though.
It was around in the 20s and 30s. It's just that it comes in ways that people like progress in this country always moves slow. So you got to inch your way towards things. But
does this movie make the men look bad, really.
I mean, it kind of looked bad.
I have to sit there and say, though, things haven't changed that much. Have you ever watched the Real Housewives program?
No, I haven't watched any lately.
You know what I was thinking? More Sex in the City is kind of the evolution of this.
Yeah, possibly. It's about the same, that they're all good friends, they're all close. But they really, I guess, do they gossip about each other? Or they talk to each other about each other?
Well, not when they're filming, but God forbid, God knows what happened with Kim Cattrall and those other three girls.
Maybe she left because what happened? She just not get along
her and Sarah Jessica Parker didn't get on, and Sarah Jessica Parker got on with the other one, the lesbian one, which I've heard out.
Nixon.
So they got on, and so they started bullying her for whatever reason, because she was getting better, people were liking her better than their... I mean, it's all convoluted sort of thing to the simple fact that, you know, Kim Cattrall almost walked off the set of the movies because she was being treated like she wasn't allowed to be with them. They put her like in a trailer away from everyone.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying this sort of stuff still happens today. I mean, any Real Housewife program, I mean, go watch any of them. It's all like this. So... we might sit there and, you know, look at ourselves like, oh, we've really progressed, but we really haven't progressed that far because we now have a franchise that's dedicated to this kind of behavior.
But yeah, you can't really judge a movie's morals from, you know, 90 years ago versus today.
So I try to put yourself in the context of the day. And back then, a lot of women did suck it up and deal with it. You know?
Yeah.
I said before, I mean, the thing is, you couldn't get divorced anyway. It wasn't legal.
Right.
You know, and it was only legal if you had enough money to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, divorce didn't become, I mean, another thing is, I mean, when my parents divorced, I was in 1972. And when I went to school, I was like, you know, I was like a pariah. It's like no one else's parents are divorced. Of course, by the time I got to high school, almost every one of my friends' parents had been divorced that time. But in 72, we were the only kids divorced. Yeah. And everyone looked at us like we were like weird. You know, that was
I remember knowing a few people that were divorced. And it was kind of strange for back then, now that I think about it. Yeah.
Well, nowadays it's weird if your parents are still together. Now you're the weird kid if your parents are still together.
So. Hey, my parents stayed together until my mom died. So
my parents are 90 and still together, sharing the oxygen.
But today that would be, but today, if you were a kid going to school and your parents are still together, you'd be looked at. So this is a bit weird.
Wait, your parents love each other?
Yeah.
And that's crazy.
But at this time, I mean, divorce was hard to come by. So, I mean, it makes perfect sense, you know, what they said. And if you had the means to get divorced, you had to have money.
How do you handle the ranch in if you're doing the women as a modern movie? Like, I'm kind of interested to know if the more recent remake, was it set in modern times? Or was it
modern times? I believe
it's set in modern times. I saw it once. I didn't like it at all. We actually were going to cover that before The Opposite Sex, and then I remember The Opposite Sex was a remake, so I'd rather do that than this horrible movie. But the thing is, the balance is off. I mean, it's like they're all friends and all this stuff's happening and they're all pulling together, and it's
2008.
It's kind of a different kind of movie altogether.
Nick Ryan, Eva Menendez, Deborah Messing, Jada Pinkett Smith. There you go. You know, there's a
It's a more of a female buddy film than it is.
Yeah, it looks like it, yeah, that's what it looks like.
And the thing about the women is a satire of socialite women at that time. So that it's not a documentary or the way all women were. It was a satire of socialite women, and that's what I quite like about women. That's probably why I would give it a 5-star rating, because
it's modern day. It's set in the same.
Yeah.
I don't know if I want to watch it though. It just doesn't.
It's on Netflix.
Yeah, I saw that. I don't know. I just kind of like to remember this one with the class of the 1939 version. Mm. I actually hate it when they. I hate to say this because someone's going to hate me, but I mean when you go from that. I hate to say this too. That caliber of actresses to the present caliber that was doing them. Not that there's anything wrong with them. But something, at least in my opinion, gets lost in translation.
When you think about the women from 1939, when you think of the cast from that movie were, you know, huge stars. That the cast list that you read off, they're not the biggest stars of today.
Right.
So it's kind of strange. Like if it was like Margot Robbie,
right?
You know, Scarlett Johansson. You got to think of like the massive megastars of today.
Right.
And to be honest, you wouldn't even be able to afford the making of that movie anyway. By the time you put Julia Roberts in, there's 16 million right there. You know what I mean? And then you start putting these huge stars in there. It's like,
yeah,
you
never going to make that money back.
You don't have enough money for the film locations now.
That's a good point. That's a really good point. Because people you got to pay for the big biggies, you got to pay for them.
And in this era, we had the studio system. So basically,
everyone's already under contract. Yeah, everyone's already under contract. So it works out. But yeah, in this,
you are doing this movie. You're in contract.
I mean, also at that point in 1939, people will go see something blindly without knowing what it's about. Nowadays, unless it's every time I go to a movie theater and it's not a Marvel movie, a DC movie, a Star Wars movie, a Fast and the Furious movie, a Saw movie, something that's a major franchise.
Industry movie, basically.
Yeah, the theater's empty whenever I go to anything that isn't one of those. So you, if you were to throw that caliber of cast together for this, would their name value alone even draw?
I think it would. Thing,
but you got to remember, I mean, to go to the cinema now, you have to almost take a second mortgage out. Yeah. That's a difference as well. But it's true though. I mean, the thing is like, you know, I remember like in the 80s, I would go test movies out because we would do that because movies weren't that expensive.
Right.
I mean, it's like a pound or $2 or whatever, like that's good to a movie.
$1.50,
which was not expensive. So you can go there, especially if you went in the afternoon, it was even cheaper.
Right.
But and if it's a bad movie, okay, it's $1.50. Now, I mean, here it's $30 to go to the movies, 30 quid to go to the movies here. I mean, it better be a freaking good movie because this is
that
30 quid that I'm spending to go to the movies, I can go to the theater and sit in the back for that.
Yes.
You know,
exactly. I would much rather spend my money at the theater than go to the movies.
Well, I don't want to spend 30, but I don't want to spend 30 quid looking at a bad theater production either, because that's 30 quid.
Well, you got to do reviews.
You got to take a chance sometimes.
That 30 quid
is one tenth of my heating bill for the
month. We're not going anywhere right now because we also have to heat and eat here in Texas.
But I'm saying now what you do is what you do if something happens you're not quite sure about. If you wait 4 to 6 weeks, you can see that same movie that you're spending 25 to 30 quid on, and you can either stream it for a tenner, or you can buy the DVD or Blu-ray, whatever streaming service, Paramount, Peacock, Hulu.
Well, buying the DVD or Blu-ray is what I like. What was that? There was a Nicolas Cage movie last year that I wanted to see, and I remember Pig. The rental. Huh?
Pig.
Oh no, I still haven't seen that. Pig is very, very good. It was the one where he's fighting like the animatronic creatures, and I was like, okay, I guess. And I remember the rental was like $20. And then when I look on Amazon, I'm like, the DVD is $20. Why am I going to spend $20 to rent it when I can spend $20 and have the DVD on my shelf for the rest of my life?
But if you waited 3 weeks, you could have rented it for $2.99. That's the thing as well.
The reviews
were like, I do.
Bad. And like by the end of the year, it was like a 99-cent rental on iTunes. But I wanted to see it. I was like it's Nicolas Cage fighting animatronic monsters, and it's
I've not heard of that one. What's it called?
Late Night at something or other.
Okay. I don't remember. I don't think I heard of
Willy's Wonderland.
Okay. Willy's Wonderland. Heard of it. It's got its place.
It's not as fantastic as I was hoping it would be.
It has a good idea, but I don't think it's sold very well.
Nicolas Cage doesn't say a word throughout the whole movie, which I think is, you can't afford to pay me to talk, guys. So
the kids are quite annoying. So you kind of wish they'd just kill the kids off. So it has that kind of a problem going on. So the kids are, I think if they had a more likable cast, it might have played a little bit better.
I mean, if you're going to see it for Nicolas Cage beating up animatronic creatures that are attacking. That's it.
Yeah. Murder.
But don't expect anything more than that.
Yeah. Shakespeare is not shaking in his boots at the moment for it. So let's put it that way.
Are you looking for a graphic design that will take you to the next level? Or something that shows confidence within a growing market to help you stand out amongst the crowd? Amazing Designs gives consistent and on-brand designs, whether you are looking for something conservative or you want to let your imagination soar. They bring professionalism to a high standard, and they are able to visualize your ideas and give them that extra edge. Working one-on-one with their designers will give you a design that will live up to your expectations and more. Affordable, expert designs for all occasions, whether it's logos, brochures, or whatever you can dream up. Amazing Designs is your to-go place for creativity and hands-on expertise. Try Amazing Designs today. Contact them via email at amazingdesigns505@gmail.com. That's amazingdesigns505@gmail.com, or reach out by phone at Crunchy Cold 1-805-203-0427. We love them so much here at the Literary License Podcast that we use them ourselves.
Well, this brings us to our next feature, which is The Opposite Sex, which is a 1956 American musical romance comedy film shot in Metricolor and CinemaScope. The film was directed by David Miller and stars June Allison, Joan Collins, Dolores Gray, Anne Sheridan, and Ann Miller, with Leslie Nielsen, Jeff Richards, Agnes Moorehead, Charlotte Greenwood, Joan Blondell, and Sam Levine. The Opposite Sex is a remake of the 1939 comedy film The Women, and both our films are based, of course, on the original 1936 play. What we're going to do is cut to the trailer of The Opposite Sex and be right back.
Why do men who should know better gape at a well-filled sweater? What's there about it that keeps them craning their necks? The answer is the opposite sex.
Hello, darling. I'm in the tub. Shriveled to a peanut, waiting for you to call.
In the tub? It's too bad there isn't a television attachment on this phone.
Look, if I can get out a little later on, you take off your spurs and meet me at the car.
Now hold it, honey. Can I call you back? I've got some people here I want to talk to. Okay? Howdy, folks. I'm here to give you the bare facts about the opposite sex. I'm Buck Winston when I play in this picture. In person, I'm Jeff Richards, the lucky guy MGM cast opposite all the feminine beauty in the opposite sex. Oh, what women. For instance, there's June Allison as Kay. Kay had been a famous singer.
On the man with the two front names, Harry James. The young man with a horse. That's a lot of things.
Ann Sheridan, as Amanda, has her own ideas about the opposite sex.
Females, the lost sex, substituting fashion for passion and the analyst couch for the double bed.
Dolores Gray is Sylvia, a good listener when someone's dishing the dirt.
Well, you can't blame him, really. You should see this Crystal Allen.
Yes, you really should see Crystal Allen. Played by seductive, sultry Joan Collins.
Don't give me that innocent bit. I do kicks, you plug tunes.
But we both knew a good thing when we saw it.
What's the matter, Mrs. Hilliard? Did I hit a nerve?
This is Gloria, ready to love, honor, and betray. It's Luscious Ann Miller. And here are those riotous four-time losers in the Reno Handicap. Agnes Moorhead and Charlotte Greenwood. The opposite sex is spiced with eye-filling production treats, set to the beat of hip tunes and toe-tapping rhythms.
Now, 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 baby, now.
And, backed by Art Mooney's band, here's yours truly, old Buck Winston and his guitar. Sex. Mighty popular idea, I reckon. One is here to stay.
Hello, welcome back to the Lucha Lessons Podcast. We're covering The Opposite Sex from 1956. And yo, Vicky, what's your version or view of The Opposite Sex?
I really like this one, only because I love June Allison. You know, I haven't seen too many movies. I loved her in, The Glenn Miller Story, I believe. She played in that, too. I don't know why I love that movie. I just loved it. Well, my mother was a child of the 40s and stuff. And so we used to watch all these old movies. And I don't know. June Allison, she's not really what you call a blonde bombshell, but she's like total theater brought to the silver church of the screen.
She's quite homely, isn't she? She's quite homely.
I don't think,
girl.
You know, but if you look at her in different ways, she's not. I mean, she's just one of those people I can't figure out. Is she cute? Is it whatever? Is it the haircut? But I mean, and then you've got...
She has a face for television and not big screen. I think she looks better on a smaller screen. I don't know if I'd want to see her in a great big, in an IMAX presentation.
Well, you got Joan Collins, you got Leslie Nielsen, who I just keep thinking of the Naked Gun every time I see Leslie Nielsen. It doesn't matter what book or what movie it is, he's always going to be, you know, it's Shirley.
He's always going to be Frank Drebin.
It's hard to absorb his previous roles as a sex symbol kind of thing, and then think of how he ended up doing the Naked Gun and all his other movies, because, I mean, he's hysterical. He's great at it. Don't get me wrong.
Repossessed.
But, I mean, no, but you got Ann Sheridan, Ann Miller. You got Carolyn Jones. You got Bill Goodwin. You got Charlotte Greenwood. You got a ton of star power in this one, because they actually have the men in it, which gives you a little more context into the story, which I kind of enjoyed having the men.
Well, you got Juanita Moore appearing in there as well. Juanita Moore, you'll know her as, I'm so sorry for Imitation of Life. And you're like, right. Where did she come from? It's like, I mean, I wish she had more of a role, because she was excellent in Imitation of Life. But you see her pop up and you're going, oh my God, where did she pop up from? I think that's the only other time I've seen her in anything. It's like, Dean Jones is in it as well. So it's like, you know, from...
Carolyn Jones, she was a kid in this, really. She was so young in this. I mean, she said she played a wise ass really good, because she's such a wise ass. And I mean, you just got all these people. I didn't see this one either. I love every actor in it, you know? And I mean, I just couldn't see any downside to this film any more than I could the other one. Plus, it actually gave you the spin with the guys in here. And they could have Mr. Magoo, you know?
I know Mr. Magoo. I was going to say Mr. Magoo's in as a psychiatrist. But wasn't he also in...
Gilligan's Island.
That's it.
Jim Backus. I was watching, going, who is that? He looks so familiar. And then I looked up, Jim Backus. Okay, there we go.
Well, he played in a lot of 50s comedy roles as bad, character actor kind of thing.
Also, I want to say I've seen him in a lot of film noir movies lately from the 40s and 50s. The one that stood out to me, though, because I was like, when's Joan Blondell going to show up? And I did not recognize her throughout the whole movie. Until finally I looked it up. I'm like, wait, that's Joan Blondell right there? Like Anne Sheridan looks like Anne Sheridan from 20 years ago. Joan Blondell, man, she did not age well.
She looked better. She actually looked better in Grease than she does in this film.
Yeah, kind of. I felt bad for her though. I mean, she was quite a sex kitten back in the day, wasn't she?
Well, I'm kind of wondering did she gain weight for that role though as well, because she's the one Countess? With all the kids.
Yeah.
Oh no, she's the Countess. Edith. Countess, Joan Blondell is Edith Potter, the one with all the kids.
Oh wait, okay, yeah, you're right, yeah.
So I'm wondering, maybe she put on some weight to play that role because she has all these kids. I mean, she has like 12
that's
kids
right. And then she keeps getting pregnant. Yeah.
No, the Countess is Agnes Moorehead from Bewitched.
That's right. Yeah, I'm getting my universes crossed again.
But I have to. I love seeing Alice Pierce as Olga.
Gladys.
You know. Yeah, it's not the first time I haven't seen Abner.
I know, and she's still doing the same shit. She's gossiping and not minding her own business.
And I think this might be the earliest movie I've ever seen. I've seen Ann Miller in Room Service, so never mind that. I was going to say this might be the earliest role I've ever seen her in, but she was in the Marx Brothers Room Service.
I love Ann Sheridan.
I saw her in Kiss Me, Kate. I don't know what year that was.
I didn't know Ann Sheridan was born down the road from me either. She's born in Denton, Texas. I had no idea about that.
Yeah, along with Brad and Janet.
She was in Angels with Dirty Faces, wasn't she? Yes, she was.
Ann Sheridan? Yeah. Ann Sheridan, I still look beautiful. I love her sexy, husky voice.
Not too soon after this.
About 15 years after this. Like, this was one of her last movies. She kind of retired. Then she started making a comeback in television and then died of, I think, esophageal cancer or something like that.
How sad.
Always liked her. Everything I've seen her in, and I recently saw her in, I recently watched the movie Black Legion, where she's in that with Humphrey Bogart. She did a lot of stuff with Bogart. I'm just looking at myself now. She was in a lot of movies with Bogart. As far as Cagney, I think only Angels with Dirty Faces.
I think she did two with Cagney.
I think she was also in Angels Wash Their Faces, which that had Ronald Reagan. That had Ronald Reagan in the role of basically Pat O'Brien.
She was in Mississippi with Bing Crosby, W.C. Fields. She did The Glass Key, The Red Blood of Courage.
She's someone else that had like a really interesting backstory. She starts out at Paramount and she's basically a chorus girl in the background of like a ton of movies. She finally starts getting her break and while she's working for Paramount, then they started loaning her out to like the smaller studios and she's really doing a great job in the smaller studios. And then eventually her contract with Paramount expires. She goes over to Warner and that's where she like completely blows up. Warner actually gave her a shot and actually gave her own movies, which I saw two of them around Halloween season, called Mystery House and The Patient Room 13, I think were the two of them. But she's somebody that I really, in the last year or so really started to appreciate her work. Where are they? I'm going to find them real quick. Yeah, Patient in Room 18 and Mystery House, which are two kind of comedy mysteries that kind of make, kind of poke fun at the old dark house tropes.
Right.
So she's somebody that I've really, really started to admire lately. And this is the latest film that I saw her in because I was, because I realized, like, I didn't see a lot of her stuff in the 50s, I don't think. And she only made one more movie after this. I really wish that she would have had a larger body of work.
I really loved her.
Making her resurgence. I absolutely adore her in this. They eliminated the mother character. She seems to kind of replace the mother character in this. And I kind of like that about her. She's like 40, 41 at this point. So she's kind of got that kind of matronly vibe.
Yeah.
Still, you know, she looks very similar to what she did in her, you know, in her days at Warner in the 20s or in the 30s when she was in her 20s. But she just looks, you know, looks like a 40-year-old version of that woman.
And Ian Miller, she doesn't sing or dance in any of this. Do you notice that?
Well, I mean, there are other films that she didn't do. I mean, Ann Miller's been around for a while. She's also in the classic movie Stage Door with Katharine Hepburn and Lucille Ball's first movie.
Right.
Ann Miller appears in that. So she's been hanging around Hollywood for a long period of time. And that was in the 30s.
Lucille Ball is someone else that started out in Paramount as a chorus girl.
Right.
Yeah.
She wanted to be a star. She didn't want to do what she did, but she ended up being.
I mean, But the interesting thing is that June Allison wasn't the person they wanted for this role. No. It was supposed to be Grace Kelly.
Yeah, that's right. I'd read that. Grace Kelly was supposed, but then she'd retired from acting.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because they could not have their Princess of Monaco making love to other actors on TV.
To be honest, I think that she probably would have brought a bit of class to it. June Allison, I like June Allison. She's kind of like the girl next door kind of thing. But I was quite shocked that June Allison doesn't sing. Apparently, they had someone dubbing her singing voice.
June Allison can sing, I thought.
No, her voice is dubbed in this, her singing voice. So obviously,
well, I know they dubbed the main song that was intended for her. It's a mad wait. Where, what song was that? Now it's going to bug me. I can't find it. Joanne Greer, nope, not her.
The one where she meets Leslie Nielsen at the end of it. Is that the one you're talking about?
Yeah.
You know, Joan Collins was on loan from 20th Century Fox for this too.
Joan Collins, they didn't know what to do with her at this point in her career.
You know, they used her backside for three different actresses in this. They would superimpose the head on her. I'll find the note that I put down.
Yeah, but she made the girl with the red swing at that time. It's like didn't know what to do with her. You know, she came. I mean, she's very beautiful at this point. I mean, she's still beautiful, but she was.
God, have you seen her still? It's just ridiculous. She must be a vampire or something.
There's a really good documentary that she talks about her career and Jackie and everything like that. And of course, Dynasty is what would actually be the thing that would shoot her forward. Besides her soft porn films that she did, like The Bastard and The Stud, that were huge successes in the late 60s, early 70s. But she's very, very good in this. And, you know, I think this is probably, you know, if you look at her early Hollywood films, this one pretty much stands better than some of her other films that she was doing at this time, Joan Collins. And to be honest, this is probably one of the only ones I really do remember. I've seen the other ones that she does, and she doesn't really stand out as much as she does this. She does appear in the Betty Davis Elizabeth film.
It says on a one-sheet poster, Joan Collins' backside was also used for the four other actresses, June Allison, Ann Sheridan, Dolores Gray, and Ann Miller, whose heads were rather haphazardly attached afterwards. Allison's image suffers the most from this unfortunate procedure by the retouching department.
Yeah, that's on the poster. So
now I got to go look at the movie poster again.
The movie poster is actually on the DVD.
Oh, cover. Okay, yeah, I'm
gonna grab it right now. I see it sitting right there. I'm gonna go grab it.
Yeah, it looks really stupid. Yeah, it's stupid. Who okayed that? Never in a million years. And I don't even have that much anything with graphics. I would never okay something like that.
Oh my God! I did not notice that until now. Oh wow.
Weird, isn't it?
No, because that's what the movie poster, isn't it? I hate that movie poster, actually.
It's a pretty terrible movie poster.
Yeah, like I said, who okayed that?
It looks like something that they were pretty much setting up to fail, isn't it? It's kind of got that
kind
of feel.
And Barbara Jo Allen, who plays Dolly DeHaven, also appeared in the 1939 version in an uncredited bit as the receptionist. Remember Dolly?
And I went back and looked at the 1939 poster, and that one's not much better either.
No. Mm-hmm. What were people thinking back then?
Well, then I had to say I prefer the 1939 poster because at least that's a painting, and it does look, you know, it's very
nobody
it very
much
it very much looks at that era, where this one just kind of it doesn't even look. I mean, if you look at 1956, what else came out that year? Gentlemen for Blondes. And that poster's a hell of a lot better than this.
Yeah.
It's almost like MGM's like, oh, let's just get this out. We don't care what you do. Let's just get this out. We don't care. It's almost felt like that.
And that haphazard thing came back to bite him in the ass because this movie was a flop.
I can understand why it is kind of a flop because even though you have these great actresses and stuff like this, the first women film for me, they feel like there's cohesiveness there. And they feel like for some reason that these people are friends outside of it and they're probably hanging out together. The actresses don't quite gel with each other. There seems
not
to be
like
a lot.
They did with the other one. And almost like this Sylvia is forgiven. Well, this Sylvia is much more vicious than the other Sylvia.
This Sylvia, she is not, like she's just conniving. But she's not like they didn't have George Cukor to tell her, you know, play it in a way that makes you somewhat likable. Because like this Sylvia even
was not likable.
She even looks like a woman who's had too much Botox and like is, you know, her
son,
you know,
everything else.
Everything about her just doesn't gel. She's not as fun.
You can't hold a candle to the other performance when it comes to Sylvia. I'm sorry.
No, because Rosalind Russell, like I said in the earlier, she steals every scene
she does.
In.
You can't compare the two because there's no comparison.
Who else is?
I mean, Dolores Gray is kind of a weird thing anyway. Because I mean, she's more of a Broadway actress sort of thing, and she used to do musicals. She did a lot of Sondheim musicals, like Follies and things like that.
That's the thing. Go ahead.
But it just seems like. You know, she like did Andy Get Your Gun on Broadway, Kiss Matt, It's Always Fair. Well, you know, she is in a movie called Designing Women with Lauren Bacall. But her main thing is on Broadway. So what you have is you got these movie actresses. You got June Allison being a movie actress. You got Joan Collins kind of being this English actor. You can tell that she's English because her English accent kind of slips every once in a while, you know, to do with her Americanness. And then you got Dolores Gray being like a Broadway actress playing against these movie actresses, which they're a totally different vibe altogether. So it's kind of like, and they all don't seem to, you know, I can't believe that June Allison, even when June Allison's hanging around her friends, I can't see her hanging around these people.
Do you know that June Allison, remember when she slaps Joan Collins in this? Do you know that she hit her so, actually knocked Joan Collins unconscious?
Really?
When she hit her, yeah. And apparently because of the bathtub scene, she developed an allergy to the bath soap and bubbles because they kept putting her in the bathtub. Poor Joan Collins.
So the little girl coming in and be like, no, the bubbles make me sneeze actually happened to Joan Collins. That's actually kind of funny.
Yeah, but and little Allison there, June Allison knocked her out. I guess she cold cocked her pretty good. So I didn't know that. So I'm just sitting here reading these notes.
Also, the daughter here is the little girl from Them.
It is?
Yeah. Them!
It is. It is her. Yeah. Oh my God, you're right. Well,
there was another one. There was another one the whole time. I'm just like, who is she? She looks familiar. And then when I finally looked it up, I'm like, oh, of course. She's the one who first sees the ants.
You're right. I didn't know that. How cool is that?
And I have a problem seeing the men in this as well. Because the thing is the other ones, you kind of picture them. Now that you see Buck with singing, you're like, what in the hell are they going for this person for? It's like when you get that scene in the rowboat.
Right.
You're like, this is gonna like.
That was the funniest part of the whole friggin' movie was ma'am. Ma'am.
Ma'am.
He was funny. You know, I'm sorry, but he was great. He was a nice touch.
I did like it. I did like the men being left to the imagination, because like you do get a sense of, well, how amazing must these guys be for these women to, you know,
have you ever watched Springer? Women will fight over anything.
I know.
But the thing is that when you're seeing the men in here, it's like when you hear about Buck Winston and when they're talking about him in the original, you have this picture. It's like, oh, he's probably this great big strapping Rory Calhoun kind of guy or something, or, you know, or this great big, you know, good looking cowboy.
Well, he was kind of a big strapping guy.
Well, he kind of looked more, he was more gay Borough man than Marlboro man. Let's just put it that way.
I
think it's because he's like singing and I don't know. I mean, he did come off the set of Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, so that doesn't.
That's right. Matter. He was in that. Oh my God. So
that doesn't help matters much. And I mean, all those brothers look like they're better off going off with each other than going off with the brides.
I watched that movie at all. Only you would ruin Seven Brides for Seven Brothers for me. Jesus.
Well, it's just like, I mean, it's just like when you got all these guys jumping around and like, hey, yeah, howdy, pal. Yeah. So like, it's like, oh, okay. And is that the most masculine thing that you want to see? You know, it's like, even though ballet dancers are more fit and they have really, Mikhail Bershikov is very masculine, but once you see him dancing, it kind of takes away the masculine sheen a little bit.
And if you look at his pictures, yeah, I guess he does might have that kind of vibe.
I mean, I don't know anything about him personally. And even like Leslie Nielsen, you're like watching them and he looks like a poor version of Peter Graves from Mission Impossible.
He does. Yes, he does. He does. He does. I was trying to figure out who he looked like, and that is a good one. Yep.
And the thing is, if he had like this great big strong male character playing him and then getting lost in his relationship with Joan Collins for whatever reason, and I think it would have off-centered it, but what you do is you got the weak version that you're hearing from the 1930s now you're seeing the visualization of that weak version, and therefore it's like, so you're looking at the whole thing going to Gene Nelson's like, why are you with him? Because he's like, he's just hearing, he's about funny. Someone being weak and seeing someone being weak are two different things,
right?
You know, so when you hear about this thing, because think, oh, he's a great father, he's a great husband, and they have a good relationship, and even though that he might be weak for because he's, you
who
know,
played the
he's
daughter?
Falling for
she's
this man trap.
What was her name again?
The little girl from Them. I don't remember her name.
To find him, you know, so hearing about him falling for this man trap, so the thing is, you kind of cut him a little bit of slack that, okay, well, maybe he's being, you know, he's being played, especially like in the original, you have Joan Collins playing him. Well, it's my birthday. I'll save you a cake with a candle on it.
If I kept calling Scott darling and woo-doo-doo-doo-doo, he'd look at me like I was fucking high or insane or something. Just,
yeah,
darling,
but the thing is, if you were someone he's never talked to before, and they start that situation up, and that's what that's the way they always talk to you, it might be something, you know, it would be something. Now, if I did that
to
someone
for back then, but there's so much.
Well, no, but what I'm saying is that what you got is a woman coming on to you and like going, oh, like you're king of the castle, like you're a god, and that's and so when you hear that sort of thing, so you can paint that in your mind. But now that when you see the interaction between these two people, you're thinking, what the hell is he doing? He's like, do you know what I mean? Because it didn't really play that well. And the thing is, like when he's got, you know, he's at the zoo and Joan Collins shows up at the zoo, you know, Crystal Allen shows up at the zoo, and you're kind of going,
yeah.
You know, but saying that, what I do love about this movie is the simple fact of all the actresses in it.
And well, yeah, absolutely. There's no downside with all that. It's just like the other one. I mean, it might be a different, you know, tell. But I mean, all the actresses are just badass.
I mean, I like seeing June Allison. I mean, the thing is, it's one of those names that, you know, you're so familiar with, but I'd only known a couple things that she's done. Glenn Miller's story is one of them. I, you know, but she's one of these people that, you know, you always hear about. I'm sure she probably appeared on Love Boat.
I think she was a dancer. She was more Broadway than anything else.
You know, And I mean, yeah,
she was a dancer on Broadway. She signed with MGM in 43. She did Two Girls, a Sailor because she had that Girl Next Door thing. She got Golden Globes for Too Young to Kiss. I mean, she'd been around. 40 Carats, yeah. No Known Annette. But I mean, she wasn't like the Joan Crawford powerhouse kind of thing. But I mean,
she's like a 1950s MGM name, wasn't she? I guess that's what I always think of her as. But she was a dancer. But what I do like about this is like Agnes Moorehead pops up. It's like, I'm excited about that.
I know. I get all excited when I see Agnes Moorehead pop up in anything. I just adore her as an actor. I mean, she was a great character actress. Did she ever get like, it's sort of like, did she ever get the main role of anything?
I mean, she's the main catalyst in Citizen Kane. She comes from that Mercury Theater a lot. That's where she comes from.
Right. She's another
one. Sweet Charlotte. She was up for an Oscar for that, wasn't she?
That's right. She was.
She's the lead in The Bat. She's the co-lead with Vincent Price.
Yeah.
Is she?
She was in
Showboat. Sorry, wrong number.
She was in Twilight Zone. She's the farmer woman with all the little spacemen coming in, and she's trying to kill them.
I forgot.
That's her.
When you say Showboat, is that the James Whale Showboat? I haven't seen that yet, and I want to.
Where did I just see it?
I would suggest it's probably the fifth. Is it the fifth?
No, it's Hammerstein.
Oh, okay. It's later.
The 1950, I think the 19 Ava Gardner one, probably.
It was a 1951 American musical romance drama that she did based on the 1927 stage musical, the same name by Jerome Kern. Hammerstein.
Yeah, that's the one with Ava Gardner. That's the one with Ava Gardner in it.
And Joey Brown.
A mixed race woman. Ava Gardner playing a mixed race.
Oh, she was playing a mixed race woman.
Yeah.
I forget.
Showboat, basically the premise of Showboat basically is it's about the singer on the showboat and everyone's in love with her until they find out that she's mixed race. That's what Showboat's about.
Right.
So when you get like Katherine Grayson or Ava Gardner playing that role, you're like, okay.
Yeah. They're about as lily white as it gets, but I guess it doesn't really matter.
You know.
Well, I do actually know people that have black grandparents, and
I know, but they always threw Ava Gardner in these kind of exotic sex roles anyway.
Well, because she had that look though.
It's a bit like Night of the Iguana. I mean, she's supposed to be like this exotic Mexican woman in the Iguana. True. I mean, she's brilliant in everything she does. I mean, this has nothing to do with her acting, but when you find out what her nationality is supposed to be, like, okay.
I don't remember that.
That's the one with Grayson Hall got an Oscar for that.
Oh, Night of the Iguana, that one. Okay. I thought you were talking about the other one where she's a different
That's Showboat. That's okay. It's a more Technicolor version of Showboat.
I love Grayson Hall. I think she's a great little actress too. She deserved an award. She really did.
Yeah, on one of those Criterion sales, I picked up the James Whale version of Showboat, and I have not thrown it in yet. I really want to see it. I love James Whale.
That's supposed to be the best one, actually.
Cannot wait to finally dig into that. There's so much stuff I'm looking at here. I'm like, I can't wait to watch it. I'm never going to live long enough to watch all the movies I want to watch.
There's so many movies, we'll never live long enough to watch them all.
Put them on our podcast list.
Yeah.
I would probably have not watched The Women if it wasn't on the podcast. I've wanted to watch it forever, and I've had the DVD, I bought the DVD specifically for this because I was like, okay, I know I'm going to like it because it's George Cukor, so let me just go right out and grab it. But I'm like, that's what we're going to have to do going forward, is I'm going to have to tell Keith the movies I want to see, and he's going to throw them on the podcast.
Well, we're putting season seven together, which we're kind of changing our format slightly. So
they also said the exterior set of the backstage alleyway where June Ellison and Leslie Nielsen confront one another about his affair. Remember that scene? Was also used the following year for the climatic fight scene in Designing Women, 1957, with Gregory Peck and Lauren Bacall. So they just recycled everything.
MGM sets are famous for that. If you you watch enough MGM movies, you'll Universal.
Recognizing stuff.
Yeah, you said Warner.
You watch three Andy Hardy movies, and you've pretty much seen every set you're going to see from that point forward in every small town.
Yeah, well, Gone with the Wind, they burnt down the King Kong set. I didn't know that till just like a year or two ago. That was just like one of the weird little facts.
That's because I think that was like a fuck you to RKO.
Because they bought the RKO,
they pretty much started destroying everything that RKO stood for.
Because
RKO was an independent cinema, and the major studios didn't like independent cinema.
They still don't like independent cinema.
Supposedly, some of RKO's negatives are in the bottom of the Santa Monica pier. One off the end of the pier when they were bought out because they wanted to destroy. Ooh, sorry, it's got a Charlie horse again. They wanted to destroy a lot of the negatives. So there's a lot of movies. When was it MGM that bought?
They dumped them like that.
They just dumped a bunch of the negatives off the Santa Monica.
How criminal!
But see, RKO was owned by who was it owned by? Was it Hughes?
Howard Hughes. Yes. Yes, he did.
Yeah, because RKO was owned by
MGM. And that was the problem. Was because of Howard Hughes. Howard Hughes, Hollywood didn't like him very much.
Yeah.
Well, he was a weirdo.
Well, no, he didn't start out as a weirdo. He became one over time, sort of thing, with his germ phobia and stuff like this. And then there's that whole thing with making Marion Davies. Didn't he marry Marion Davies and try to turn her into a star? There's all that going on. So,
I mean,
Marion Davies is supposed to be in this film. So
Sarnoff was the one that started RKO.
Yeah.
I
didn't know it was well-known wrestler Randy Keith Orton. I did not know.
And at that time, you also remember that David Selznick probably had a problem. He could have had a problem with Hughes as well. And they were courting Selznick madly at this time, who was doing Gone with the Wind. So, I mean, there could have been a lot of little politics games being played in the background here.
Well, I doubt anything was much different. You just didn't have social media and all kinds of stuff blitzing everything that was going on because
they were really courting Selznick at this time when he's making Gone with the Wind. Of course, he would go on to bring Alfred Hitchcock over to do like Rebecca and all that kind of stuff. So all that stuff is going in the background as well. So
that was a 1956 Lincoln convertible they had in Reno. I was trying to figure out what kind of car that was. It was driving me nuts. All I know is you probably put 20 bodies in the back, easy.
I mean, I do like the care. I mean, I do love seeing these actresses, though. And I mean, it was great seeing them because it's like you get excited every time. It's like when Alice Pierce showed up, it's like, oh my God, it's Alice Pierce from Bewitched, or oh my God, it's Agnes Moorehead. Oh my God, it's Carolyn Jones from Addams Family.
I know. I was really excited when I saw Carolyn Jones because I hadn't seen this before either. If I had, I don't remember it. But I just, something about Carolyn Jones, I just always loved and admired about her. I don't know what it is, but
I mean,
she was diverse, I guess.
But have you seen her best role ever? Is Kid Creole with Elvis Presley.
Also on my shelf, and I haven't watched it yet.
Watch it.
So
Presley made three great films. Love Me Tender.
I haven't seen it in eons.
Kid Creole and Jailhouse Rock. And then he went to the army, and then he came back, and basically was prostituted out by Colonel Tom Parker. But he had the promisings of actually being a decent. He could have been a decent actor. He could have been. You're like watching the beginnings here.
Yeah, it's like his first three or four movies are the ones that I've heard you absolutely have to see. I think I've seen Jailhouse Rock when I was a kid. I've never seen Kid Creole, as far as I know. But I came across it at Dollar Tree. So it's like $1.25. So I was like, all right, well, can't go wrong.
The Bachelor Party 1957. So 56-57 is when she would start doing her tour of duty, it looks like.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I mean, the interesting thing about
Invasion of the Body Snatchers. I don't remember her in that.
Yeah, she's the next door, she's the neighbor and with the husband, and they go, don't let us go to sleep.
She got a Golden Globe too.
I mean, Kate Creel, I mean, what's interesting about Kate Creel is directed by Michael Curtiz.
Yeah, from Casablanca. And Angels with Dirty Faces.
Yeah. So that's what makes it an interesting film. It's a well done film, actually. I highly recommend it.
We're No Angels. Yeah. Like, again, I'm looking over at all my Michael Curtiz movies.
I mean, the only Elvis Presley film I can watch is Frankie and Johnny, and that's because I love the camp value of it. I love
Frankie and Johnny. That's
because it's Donna Douglas from Beverly Hillbillies and Harry Morgan from MASH. and Harry Morgan's singing, and he can't sing, and it's brilliant.
Was it Donna? What's her face?
Donna Douglas from Beverly Hillbillies. Ellie Mae Clampett.
She was a cutie. She really was.
She was. Now she sells houses in L.A. So, well, she used
really?
To. She used to. I don't know. She might be dead now. I don't know.
I think she's passed. A lot of them are going.
Yeah, she's quite old. She's the TV version of Jane Mansfield. Basically. But probably made more money than Jane Mansfield. Poor thing. But yeah. So, anything else to add about The Opposite Sex?
I just felt like the musical stuff was kind of forced. Like in the
it kind of annoyed me a little bit. Yeah, I did not think it was annoying. They weren't bad. The scenes weren't bad. They were random. I think that's what it was. It just seemed random, I guess.
The problem basically is when you're gonna do a film and you're gonna sit there and talk about how great this person could have been. They could have been the greatest star, and they could have been they had the greatest voice and the greatest song. And then you hear the song, and then 1 minute after the song's over, you can't remember anything about it. That's a problem.
Except for the cowboy. He was funny. I'm sorry. Buck. I love Buck. I don't care. He was such a tard. I mean, you have to love the simpleton because, you know, he was stupid, but he wasn't. He knew enough not to marry Joan Collins, okay? He knew that was a bad deal.
Hey, I oh my god, I fell for a man trap like that that broke up the longest relationship that I've ever had. And when the line of dialogue came of, you know, your wife doesn't get you the way I do, I was like, shit. that line hit home because I literally fell for that line. Because I'm 29, 30 years old, and I've been with the same woman for like a long time, for like 6-7 years. Suddenly a woman who's 21 years old starts to catch my eye a little bit. We spend more and more time together. And
trouble.
Trouble.
what I liked about the original with that character is that Joan Crawford knows basically that what side her bread is buttered on, and she sits there and goes, oh, I can't run away from you because the Countess is supporting you and this guy's supporting me. And then when it all comes out, she thinks, oh, well, he's gonna have he's got a recording contract, he's got a radio show, and then she finds out that the Countess owns all that,
right?
So that's the rune here. And here it's kind of like, you know, it's like that relationship ends up being kind of odd one because it's not about that. It's
she's going to basically else. go back to doing what she was doing.
With Joan Crawford, Joan Collins, it was all, I guess it's back to work in the perfume counter.
Right. Joan Collins back to the chorus line or whatever it is she was doing.
And Joan Collins she's in the chorus. And
in the 30s, they were just straight up socialites. Here they, you know, here June Allison has a career as a singer.
She's a producer and a singer. And
And to be honest, because of the way the other movie set up, I think in this movie, I think Joan Collins, I mean, he probably would have slept with her, and he probably would have hired her in other stage productions. He probably wouldn't have married her.
Yeah.
Probably. Yeah.
You know, so I mean,
Do you think he was stupid, or was he pretending to be stupid?
I think he probably was more of a Harvey Weinstein sort of thing. You slept with him and you got a job. So it's probably more.
Or he gave you a ride in his handmade canoe.
Buck basically was preying on women anyway, because these were brokenhearted women. You know, that their marriages had broke up. So basically, he was just preying on their weak moments. And of course, you know, they'd be wooed by him in their weak moment. And I guess he would get a leg over. And then, of course, it didn't work for June Allison, because June Allison's prim, proper, and pure, because that's the kind of character she is. But that, but with the Countess, you know, she's always looking for the next, you know, the next love, you know, the love, next love adventure. So
that's, oh my god,
she's in love with being in love. That's yeah. The thing about the Countess in these movies, and both.
Oh, l'amour.
Yeah, she is in love with being in love, and once that love fades, you're out the door.
Well, you know, it's kind of cool, though, because if I was a multi-millionaireess, and just, I would probably be friggin' doing the same shit. Just like, I'll buy me a dude for a couple months.
Yeah,
buy another one.
But the funny thing about the Countess is that she's still in love with these guys until they try to murder her.
Yeah,
and they don't succeed, right, and then she gets a divorce. You know, I mean in the first movie in Reno, I mean, the guy tried to push her, they were skiing, and he tried to push her off a mountain, and of course it failed, and she's crying about the lost love. He's trying to kill you. In this one, I mean, it's just kind of like, you know, she's upset that, you know, she spent all this money on Buck and he's like left her. So, and but I mean, even her failed marriages, you're kind of going, okay. It's like,
yeah, no shit, I forgot,
you know,
about
they tried to part. You know, they tried to poison you, they tried to kill you, but you know, but you're upset that, you know, that they tried to do that to you, but you still love love. So let's give this a 5-star rating, starting with you, Vix. How many star ratings do you give this?
I want to give it a 5, but Joe brought up something that kind of, I'd probably give it like a 4.5, just because I don't mind the musical part of it, but it was kind of random, and it kind of, I don't know, kind of broke up some of the momentum of the movie for me a little bit. When they were on a roll, all of a sudden they just pull out a musical number, I guess. You know what I'm saying? But I mean, all the acting was great. The character actresses, I mean, you got a lineup like that in both movies. I mean, a wonderful lineup of just heavy hitting talent. So, I mean, just for that alone, I wanted to watch it.
Yeah.
And what about yourself, Joe?
I'd probably go 4 to 4.5. I really enjoy it. I absolutely love the movie. It doesn't have everything that the original has for me. I feel like I love the mile a minute dialogue in the first one, and I feel like the first one moves a lot better. I think the musical numbers, which again, they're producing a musical just so they can shove in musical numbers, I feel like.
Right.
Because the musical numbers also had nothing to do with the plot.
At all.
They're just there. You have the Jim Backus one, which literally doesn't need to be there. You could have
cut. I actually liked that one, though. I thought that was kind of cute.
I mean, like it, yeah. But it has no purpose whatsoever.
No, there was absolutely no purpose.
Nothing about the Jim Backus one matters at all.
Here's the scene. Stop the movie. Music number. Commercial time. And then go back to the scene.
Yeah, it adds like nothing. There's no purpose to it. But I still enjoy it for what it is. Like, you can't you can't like a movie for what it's not. You can only base it on what the movie strives to be. And this tried to be completely different from the George Cukor version, which I kind of respect. And I really have, over the last year or so, developed this affinity for Anne Sheridan, and I love seeing her in this. This is the latest movie I've ever seen her in, and I really, really, truly wish that she didn't pass away when she did, because I would love to see what she may have done in the 70s and 80s. You know, she probably would.
She didn't love
Boat. I don't know about Anne Sheridan. Anne Sheridan would have ended up there. I think Anne Sheridan.
I don't know. Everybody else did. Betty Davis did Love Boat.
Betty Davis ended up on the fuck bucket too.
Yeah, she did. I'm sure
that Joan Crawford. If
Joan Crawford didn't die, she probably would have showed up in Love Boat.
That's true. Everybody did show up on Love Boat.
She probably would have wound up like Barbara Stanwyck, like kind of doing a lot of like TV horror movies and stuff like that.
Barbara Stanwyck, I would have loved to see her in this too, actually. She
did Fantasy Island. She did Fantasy Island instead of
Barbara Love Stanwyck Boat. Fantasy Island?
Yeah, she did a Fantasy Island one.
I never saw enough.
I love her. And what's that? The Thorn Birds. Just love her in the Thorn Birds. Oh my God.
I liked her in Charlie's Angels.
Barbara Stanwyck?
Yeah, she's with Charlie's Angels. They were going to give her a spinoff, but it didn't. The spinoff didn't take off.
I don't remember that. I have to look it up.
And the Big Valley. And the Big Valley, she was in that?
Yeah, well.
I remember seeing she was in the Big Valley, but I've never seen the episode or the episodes.
Well, Linda Evans started off there as well, didn't she?
Yeah.
She's in the spinoff of Dynasty, isn't she?
She had parts.
And in the Colbys.
The Colbys, yeah.
Yeah.
She's we'll probably be talking a lot about her next week.
Barbara.
Yeah, we'll be talking about Barbara Stanwyck next week. But yeah, I've just had this affinity for Anne Sheridan, so I liked seeing her in this. She did kind of, you know, it's weird because when I see her in a lot of the movies from the 30s and 40s, she's just freshly turned 20, and she's the she's the young, youthful.
Beautiful.
I mean, she's still beautiful in this.
Yeah.
But she's the young, youthful, inexperienced woman. Now in this one, she's very matronly.
Yeah.
And it kind of touches on what Keith said earlier. Like when you get to a certain age in Hollywood, they just kind of cast you aside.
Especially the women. God, man, it's a vision.
She made the cardinal sin of turning 40.
I can't imagine. It seems like things aren't near that bad anymore when it comes to Hollywood.
Have women now that'll have decent careers well into their 60s and 70s. Right.
Yeah, I think what happened to Anne Sheridan is I think that Lana Turner took her place.
You think?
Yeah, yeah.
Because if you look at the roles that Lana Turner was doing in the 50s, Imitation of Life, Madam X, and all that kind of stuff,
right. It
was kind of, they're kind of roles that Anne Sheridan should have been doing.
There was a version of Madam X with Lana Turner?
Yeah.
You have to see that. I've only seen the one, not Norma Shearer, who's the other one? God. I've seen the two versions from the one with the woman from the Roaring Twenties. God, I'm forgetting her name. Ruth Chatterton. I saw that version from 1929, and I saw the 1937 version with Gladys George.
Those are the
two versions I've seen.
The 1966 version as Lana Turner, John Forsythe. And Ricardo Montalban.
And Burgess Meredith. I'm seeing it now. Okay, I'm going to have to check that out. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a good tearjerker. It's one of those Douglas Sirk films.
I mean, even the 29 and 37 versions are tearjerkers. But I feel like the 29 one hits better because it's before the Hays Code. So you get more of a sense of everything that she's had to go through at this point. Although Gladys George is fantastic and she can make you cry. She does it even in the Roaring Twenties 2 years later.
They do hit on those points in the Lana Turner version because they're starting to push the envelope a little bit more in the 50s.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like on the like Rebel Without a Clue cause. Right. Sorry, Rebel Without a Cause a or where's the Natalie Splendor in the Grass. So they were able to push it to that level, but still not far enough, but they're able to push it a little bit further.
When did From Here to Eternity come out? Because that was supposed to be shocking. My mother 56, said it was 57? Absolutely shocking, but what happened?
No, it was 53. From Here to Eternity was 53.
The Burt Lancaster scene with the beach thing.
I'm going to have to check out the 66 version now. I didn't realize that there was a version of Ron Turner.
I didn't either.
Yeah. It's back when all those Douglas Sirk films were really big, like Magnificent Obsession and Imitation of Life and Madam X and, you know, the soap opera movies that were really big and soppy. But it's great. I highly recommend it.
When I think of Madam X, that's what I think of. It was like, yeah, you know, kind of a soap opera feel, kind of the, It's still fantastic.
It's got all the colors. There's a lot of Vaseline-ing the lens.
if you're I guess, have you seen the 29 and 37 versions or no?
I've seen that version as well, sort of thing.
I didn't even know there was a 29 version. Is it a talkie?
It is a talkie. Lionel Barrymore directs it.
It's very gritty.
Is it?
Oh, yeah.
So that's not been cleaned up at all, or?
No, no, I'm talking about the dialogue and the way it's filmed. It's almost filmed like a gritty documentary-ish kind of.
Really?
I mean, it's a Hollywood film, but it has that kind of, it's when she goes down her descent and when she hits bottom, right. you feel kind of dirty.
When she turns into a prostitute, or? Yeah. When she goes down the shitter,
when he shows up
to start blackmailing her.
Oh, but I mean, even before that point, Jimmy. She's in the sewer.
Obviously,
she's gone from the gutter to the sewer by that time.
Clearly, so the woman's life was out of control. I'm gonna have to watch that again. So you guys got me.
All because her husband stayed away too long. So.
Yeah, well, that's what happens. We get bored too.
That's what happens when you have a bitchy mother-in-law. I think the mother-in-law in, I think it's Eleanor Parker in the Lana Turner one.
Maybe.
Is it?
There me and Joe gotta look again. This is why we never get these done in 2 hours or less.
Yeah.
It's unfortunate. It doesn't look like it's streaming anywhere. I'm gonna have to find it, like probably a DVD or something of it. I'll find it.
I bought a Blu-ray copy of it because it's a Ross.
Something is always streaming somewhere. I have learned. I can usually find anything anywhere.
It's Joan Bennett's mother. I mean, Joan Bennett's sister. It's Joan Bennett's sister who plays the. Constance Bennett, who plays the John.
It's on Prime Video, Amazon Prime.
Was it?
Well, and Keir Dooley is in it as well.
Yeah.
I found a double feature of Madam X and Portrait in Black, and that's probably how a two Lana Turner movie, so I'll probably check it out that way. $10.
Yeah. I'm saying you can get a price on it. Well, for me in opposite sex, I'm probably going to give it a 4. And that's only because there are a lot that I do like about it. It doesn't quite, I mean, if I have to pick between the two, I probably would pick the women if I had to pick between to watch the two. But I do drag out the opposite of sex every once in a while just because it's a nice curiosity
piece
sort of thing. And I love seeing, you know, as I said before, Anne Sheridan and Agnes Moorhead and Alice Pierce and Ann Miller not tapping, which is quite a relief, sort of. So, but yeah, so I'll give it a good solid 4.
So. I remember seeing Ann Miller and thinking, just call me Coco. Everyone else does from Mulholland Drive, the David Lynch movie.
What a great film to exit on, really, isn't it?
I think that was her final film, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
I think it's one of the greatest
Sheridan
films
or
no,
Ann Miller.
Ann Miller. Yeah.
Because before that, she used to appear up in those that's entertainment movies. Hi, I'm Ann Miller. I was in these MGM musicals. And you get Liza showing up going, you might not know this, but my mother was the late, great Judy Garland. It's like, yeah, we know.
Who doesn't know that at this point?
Precisely. Stop telling us. unless she was coked up, then she'd be like, hi, I'm Liza Garland. I mean, I'm Judy Minnelli. No, I'm Liza Minnelli. Oh, Liza's coked.
It's like Meghan McCain now. Meghan McCain. Yeah. I don't know. My father was the great Senator John. We know. You mention it in every sentence.
She's hypersensitive about her father, though, because everybody kind of got shitty about him.
Yeah, but she's got married and she still has his last name, so it's kind of hard not to know who she is.
Well, it's politics with that one. That's for sure.
With her, yeah. Well, she's the princess of Arizona, so
yeah,
that's
precisely
every other word out of her mouth. I'll have 2 slices, and my father was John McCain.
Exactly.
We know.
He's been working for
Liza every Minnelli day when she was on The View too.
I'll have my steak medium rare. By the way, my father was John McCain, so don't fuck this up.
She is kind of parents.
But Liza Minnelli still does it. She still does it today. It's just like, it's like, you know, seeing Concha goes, yeah, mama. I remember dancing my mama, Judy Garland, my mama.
It's kind of sad about her right now, though. She's in such decline. It's hard to see.
She was in decline after Cabaret. I mean, let's be honest. I mean,
I mean mental decline, like just going down the crapper.
Is she?
Well, yeah. No, I mean, you know, that's what happens when you keep marrying gay husbands all the time. It does your head in, doesn't it?
What does that got to do with anything? How is a gay husband going to make me gay?
Every husband she married has been gay. Peter Allen, gay.
Maybe he was bisexual.
No, he wasn't. When my baby goes to me, we go to Rio. I mean, look up Peter Allen and watch any kind of thing he's done. If there's any kind of masculinity in him, I have failed to see it in anything he's done. So, I mean, he's very talented.
I hate it when you I just have to look shit up all the
But on that note, it's time to say goodbye to Literature License Podcast. Next week, we'll be covering our There Is Always a Woman month with Double Indemnity and Basic Instinct, dealing with two women who take control of their destinies while they sit there and they screw around with their man. But they're two great classic films and are ones to be rewatched. And so we'll be back for the next part of our M&M Monsters and Mad Men series. And of course, next month is our Christmas month, which will be December, which we do things slightly different this way. Like we do every Christmas season. We'll be doing our Book the Screen, which will be the Shirley Jackson classic, We Always Lived in the Castle. And We'll Always Live in the Castle, the 2018 film starring Crispin Glover. And of course, our remake will be considering West Side Story from 1965 and the Steven Spielberg version that came out in 2021, right?
I think it was 21.
So we'll be covering on those two versions, and we'll be comparing the two of those. I imagine we'll see how different our opinions are on those.
I don't know. I'm still looking up Peter Allen and all of his flaring costumes.
And of course, our Batman series will be continuing, and of course, we'll be covering four episodes. And those four episodes for Batman fans will be Heart of Ice, The Cat in the Claw Part 1 and Part 2, and a previous one, unfortunately, I cannot remember off the top of my head, but of course, if you join up with
you lost me on Peter Allen.
So if you join up with our newsletter, of course, the fourth episode will be in there as well. So we'll be covering Batman, and of course, we'll be continuing our Doctor Who with Edge of Destruction from 1964, as we gather into the 1964 years from 63 that we just got covered for Doctor Who. So next week, remember, it's Double Indemnity and Basic Instinct. So it's good night for myself and good night, Vix.
Night, everybody.
Good night, Joe.
Good night, everyone.
See you next week.
There's always a woman to spoil the illusion, the rotten banana that ruins the bunch. It's always a woman causes confusion. There's nothing as low as a woman. We must lunch.
Love to.
Noonish.
Tomorrow.
Today.
My place.
Mine.
There's always a woman, the one disappointment, the note that goes sour and gums up the tune, the ant at the picnic, the fly in the ointment. There's nothing as low as a woman. Ring me soon.
Love to.
What?
Leaving?
I thought.
I know.
I tried.
It's always a woman. The counterfeit check.
The snake in the woodpile.
The pain in the neck.
The sand in the oyster. That isn't the pearl.
There's nothing as low as a woman. Darling girl. Pet.
Lamb.
Dove.
Fish.
The run in the stocking, the snag in the zipper, the weather in London, the water in France. It's always a woman, it's Jacqueline the Ripper. There's nothing as low as a woman. Shall we dance?
Waltz.
Tango.
Can-can.
Rumba.
Schottisch.
Gabot.
Cha-cha.
Tap.
Bolero.
Polka.
Bridge.
Two hearts.
Three clubs.
I pass.
Uh-huh. There's always a woman, a crimp in the writing, the hole in the sidewalk, the gum on the shoe. She almost looks human, it must be the lighting. Whatever it is, it's a woman. How are you?
Fine.
Pity.
It's always a woman, the hand in the till.
The $5 diamond,
the $3 bill.
A genius for trickery, that's second to none. There's nothing as low as a woman.
Isn't this fun?
Lovely.
Charming.
Delicious.
Stunning.
Fabulous.
Gorgeous.
Exquisite. A knife would be perfect.
A gun would be perfect.
It's quick and it's quiet.
At least I could try it.
I hear they do wonders.
And you can do wonders.
With poisonous gas.
With slivers of glass.
There's always the quarry.
There's always curare.
She'd never be found.
I have some around.
A noose is efficient.
Bamboo is efficient.
She won't make a sound.
As long as it's ground.
Whatever will do it.
Whatever will do it.
If anything will.
If anything will.
There's nothing as low as a woman.
Crook,
crook,
fake,
whore,
bag,
leech,
crow,
witch,
ghoul,
police,
shoot to kill.